The software was like, don't recognize the camera. And I'm like, come on, man. Come on with the games. We about to get into this evening. And I don't have time for any kind of disturbances. But needless to say, that moved itself out of the way. As you know, we always come in here. We dial in. I've actually started this about 4 minutes early. And that way, we have lots of time to smooth into this. So that way, we can kind of start on time. Let me see here. Let me get that timer going here. Where we at? Where we at with you, timer? The clock. We start the timer. Okay. All right. So the timer is hitting it. So I'm going to do a little sound check real quick, Sean. How am I sounding over there on that side of things? I'm looking good. Okay. Now I'm already supposed to be broadcasting live on YouTube. Let me check over there. Okay. Yeah. Something's going on. Let me pause this so we don't get the reverb. And so it looks like things are good over there too, but I will ask, you know, just to check the sound over there because we can boost it a bit over on this side. And then that way we make sure that everybody that is joining us on this lovely event has the opportunity to even hear us on that side of things. So let me go ahead and get that music happening again. As I said, we're a little bit early. We're going to start at the top of the hour. We're going to send it around through the galaxy of wholeness and balance vibrations, but let's give it a minute.
The Thessalonian you're fighting. He's the biggest man I've ever seen. I wouldn't want to fight him.
That's why no one will remember your name.
Purpose. Our purpose.
We have here nitric acid, glycerine, and a special mixture of my own.
Arise, for everybody that's joining us this evening, this is probably the best time to get your Palo Santo, your sage, everything that you may need for this evening, some water, some fire, all of the elementals, whatever you need to balance out is probably a good idea. Broadcasting on YouTube and worldwide, haven't done that in a while, especially live. It's great to be here. Great to see everybody. D. Conway. Heyoku, Mr. Crown, Carmen Holness, tribe in the house. We just getting started on this side of things. Everything's looking good. The dashboards, the switchboards. I am in the house, just in case you're wondering. It's not a voiceover. What's good? What's good, everybody? All right, so this is what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and get this round of love across the galaxy happening early so that way, you know, we don't stretch out to that 30-minute mark on that wholeness and balance vibrations. This is how we do it. So if this is your first time, first and foremost, catching a live, we give thanks. And also, you can push number one if you're in any of these chats because I love to kind of test the waters and see, you know, who's in here for the first time so I can kind of know how to onboard this. And beyond that, this is where we get a chance to hear from you. If you want to share, of course, I have two lines going on here. So this is actually Tribe Vibe. So for those that are in YouTube, and I think this is actually going out to Facebook also, then you're participating this evening, but the tribe is also on the line. So how we always love to do this, we love to do this with beginning by sounding off. Now, they talk about how, you know, there's this process or procession where everyone comes in and reports. And if you're not there, then, you know, something's just got to say, hey, you know, he's asleep. It's kind of like that same thing from attendance class or in class when they, hey, who, you know, is he here? Like, here, I'm here. So that's what we do. And we do that by saying wholeness to the world, letting us know, letting everybody know where we're at. And yeah, just sending love. So I'm Seven Bomar. I'm here in Costa Rica, as you know, and I'm feeling good. Wholeness and balance vibration. So let's go ahead and get it started that way. Wholeness. Honest mom. All right, some people are saying they're getting no sound on their end. Let's check it out. Let's see what's going on. Let's go ahead and keep sending that wholeness across. I'll go ahead and figure out what's going on with the sound, send the love to the family. All right, here I go. I see it. Let me see here. Wholeness, for those on YouTube who cannot hear the sound right now, I will, we're working on that, but you can't hear my sound, so.
This is Russell from Atlanta, Georgia.
second to make sure that everyone can at least hear me, which I think is happening right now. And So we got audio input, which of course is me. So I see that moving. And then we got audio output here. Okay. So, and that should definitely be the telestream. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to have to keep going with this. I'm going to have to go with the whole show right now, because at the end of the day, you know, they come to bask in the glow of the gods. No, just but no, we're going to get this started here in a moment. I did plan on having a little bit of onboarding time, but as I see, there's a slight audio issue. And so just in respect of those who tuned in, because they would literally be going through like 5 minutes of no audio. So we'll give them that audio. Let's just take a quick moment, though. Let me center myself, because these technical difficulties, they do have a tendency to try to get you started on the wrong foot. But that's not going to exist for us this evening. We're actually here. We're sharing. We're here in unity. We're here with the foundation. But I do want to take a moment, because I don't want to rush into this evening's build. I actually did think that I would have a little bit of time to get started. So I'm going to do a sound test again. And I'm going to ask Sean if you could do me a favor, because I changed some audio settings just to try to see if I could get it to pop over onto the YouTube side. And so I'm going to need a thumbs up from you that everything is actually the way that it was before when we started. So let me give it a moment here. Let's see here. Actually, I got another way also to broadcast everybody's message when they come through. Let's just fix it first, and then we'll come back. Okay, so it looks like everybody's saying the sound is good. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go ahead and let the tribe continue to introduce themselves and send that balanced vibration across the globe, because that's important. But I'm going to put my mic up to the speaker, so that way, you know, you'll catch it. You'll catch it. But, you know, that's a necessary part of this. So give me just a quick second. All right, so you could go ahead and send your wholeness and balance vibrations, tribe, and I'm going to point the speaker at that, and we're going to get that started in a minute. Wholeness. All right, it doesn't look like that's going to work either. Just give me a quick second, everyone. All right, let's go ahead and take some breaths. That didn't execute very well, because the speaker is actually on the floor somewhere. The mic wouldn't go to that. So why don't we just take some moments and take some breaths here? And it's got to be potent. It's got to be potent. Anytime there's all of that, you know, extra energy there, you know, you got to move that energy through. That's just like anything else in life. You know, everything beyond the moment, and you just need to keep breathing. I was just looking at something about that the other day, about how when we deal with situations that may be traumatic for us, or, you know, it may be something that scares us, we stop breathing. And in fact, the most important thing to do is keep breathing, because that's what's actually going to keep you from passing out. So that way you can stay in the game and actually figure out a solution for whatever it is that you're experiencing. So they also say that if you watch yourself in life, and you've truly reached balance, then your breath in should be at the same length as your breath out. I'll say that again. Your breath in should be at the same length of your breath out. So sometimes in life, you can just check on that, because that'll let you know, whether you're going or coming, you know, whether you're balanced or, you know, you're doing one of those more than the other. I'm also still going to take a moment. I'm going to center myself. I'm going to take some breaths myself. We did get started a little bit earlier, but we're already 11 minutes after the hour, so we're going to put some speed on it. However, fools rush in. We want to take a moment, let ourselves gather into the space. Wherever you came from, you're not there right now. You're here. If you were late, you made it. If you didn't hear the sound at first, It's on now. You should be able to hear me. And we're here to have some fun this evening. Like, we're here to build into some very powerful knowledge and to stay balanced in this. And that's exactly why I want to make sure we start with that balanced vibration and energy. And so what I'm going to do, once again, I'm going to put on some hold music and I'm going to invite everyone to just take some breaths and to just feel yourself, to allow yourself to just be you. Nothing else. No expectations. This is what we got.
Wholeness and Balanced Vibrations Tribe.
Want to give thanks to everyone who showed up in the space this evening. Everyone from the tribe, we sent a massive email blast out to everybody that was inside of the network, and those who we may have not seen in a while, those who may have not checked in on things in a while, I advise everyone to go and check in. You know, in Secret Energy, we put a lot of time, energy, and resources there. Everything is upgraded. As you know, we do deliver these wonderful metaphysics, but we also bring those very, very essential tools into your life, learning more about you, linking you with people that's in your area. It's not just about internet. It's definitely about seeing people in real life. Also giving you those tools to figure out some of your financial situation. I know they're saying we're in a recession, but remember, the money went somewhere. Could be going right into your pocket if you know what to do during this time. So we have to get in tune with that. We've put in a lot of new creations. We finally have the vector equilibriums. Cosmic clocks are on point. We bought in some new merch. And these are just all things that, remember, it's not just like we're trying to sell this to you. This is stuff that you can actually use as a new income stream for you, because we have a very healthy affiliation at the site. And we have unobtrusive marketing, which means you just share links to the knowledge and the wisdom. So let's give it 2 more minutes. Let's still take some more breaths. But I want to send love to those who have just joined, let you know we are here and we're almost ready to launch off this pad. As soon as we can make sure the foundation is straight, wholeness. Let's turn it up a little bit.
We have here nitric acid, glycerine, and a special mixture of my own.
I can't be the first one who wanted to see my youngest son. Our purpose, to create a star within a star.
It's murder. Travel around your own microcircuits without permission from the master control program. I mean, sending me down here to play games. Who does he calculate he is?
the future, to be exact. Do you really expect us to believe such a story?
Will you just...
Well, certainly. But you yourself just said that it hadn't really moved.
That's correct.
Well, then why can't we see it?
Because we're in this room on the 31st of December, 1899, but the model we just saw is perhaps 100 years away by now.
The galaxy.
Where is your tribe?
My tribe? They live in another planet in another solar system.
Right, we hit that zero mark. Let's keep taking those breaths. I know some of y'all just bubbling over like, I gotta bring it. And that's exactly, you know, you pace yourself on this one right here. These are, you know, they say, you know, they got milk. You know, they may have something like grain and porridge. Then they got meats. And then they got rocks. That's the grade. So hopefully we get a complete meal here today. Wow. This has really been 13 years now of connecting into the space and broadcasting greatness. Some have been here since the first show, believe it or not. Some of them are just walking in right now. And we appreciate that also because we know that at some point in infinity, we've connected before. Let's go ahead and get on with it then. I know some are like, okay, I'm ready. I got somebody else also on the night seven. You better hurry up because I'm going over there on YouTube. You only got a couple minutes to perform. And, you know, it's always kind of interesting because, you know, that sometimes is the vibe is, you know, you feel like that you're trying to explain something to someone or you're trying to get them to do it. And, you know, it gets a little weird, though, because after a while, you don't feel like that anymore. You don't feel like that you're trying to make anyone do anything. And so I always say is that I am describing a way of life. It's up to you to determine if you want to live it. So I'm going to take a moment again. I'm going to go pump up the volume again. This is super organic tonight. You know, when we come on YouTube, I will say, though, there'll always be a little bit extra. But, you know, we'll go that extra mile. But I'm just saying, it's like sometimes trying to go and get a little boat in a hurricane. You know, that's why, you know, I have desisted a little bit because the vibe, you know, the vibes is just something to deal with. But we're armored up. I think actually last name Bomar, you know, you can spell armor with that. You try to be. We armored up and we're ready to do whatever we have to do for our beloved. And that is really the tune of tonight because I have to bring in some very, very powerful wisdom and maintain balance, which is my responsibility. As a teacher, it is my responsibility to, if I'm given knowledge and awareness, to bring that to you in a balanced way, right? So let me do this. Let me pump it up. Pump up them lights, man. I have to save. I'll be trying to save my eyes these days. You be sitting under 53,000 Kelvin for 4 hours to see what that's like. You're like, you've been sitting in a volcano or something. Like, I'll be sweating. I'll be all greased over. Like, what happened? It's like, yo, I just delivered the message. You're like, shoot, it looked like it was fire. I'm like, yes, I was sweating. So take a moment. We're on YouTube. Hit the like button. Hit the like button and send the link to someone if you can. Meaning, like, if you got somebody that you know is drifting out there, it's Friday. You know, send them a text message. Yo, check this out when you get a moment. They may come out of one of those drunk nights from Visions or 112. I know both of those are probably gone by now, but they come out, you know, and just be like, what does God have for me? And just turn this on and change their life. You know, I guess, right? But they say when you hit the like button and something's live, people actually see it. So, you know, I'm saying push the like button so somebody may dive into this on a synchronicity and, you know, get themselves to a higher level of existence inside of their consciousness, because it's definitely available. I also say peace be still. You know, that's something that I had to remind myself. It's like when I come into this, I come in with, you know, all this love, honor, and energy. And I realized, though, be the water, my friend. Like, you can really transmit a powerful message relaxed. You know, because then you can access everything. You can access all your neurological networks. Let me do this. I was just about to do that. I was just about to mute lines. See? You can access the neurological network. I tell you, right there, my mind's like, yo, you need to mute lines. And it's sharing this. Somebody, you see? Neurological network. I'm sure it has greater benefits, but, you know, just a little sample. So my intentions here this evening, because I do want to state my intentions. My intentions are to make your existence forever better. Forever. That's my intentions. And we're going to see if by the end of this evening that my intentions have, you know, come to fruition. So I also would not like to omit, especially since this is us, to have that moment of touching and connecting. Now, I think I saw a few ones. See myself some ones. I asked earlier if you were just coming in to one of these builds for the first time, or if you're just joining Tribe Eyes for the first time, to press number one in the chat. So maybe we'll ask for that one more time. And I want to let everybody know, if this is your first time, we have this thing we call touching and connecting. I know. Remember, we on the internet, though. Wait, you know, it's like, okay. It's like, wait a minute. Wait, no, we on the internet. Hold on. You know, touching and connecting. And it starts like this. And what we do is we raise our hands in the universal symbol of everlasting life, being alive, being aware, not being sleeped, being in control of the vessel. We raise our hands because anytime you win, you do this naturally. You just be like, yeah, I won. And you won. And what happens here is that we get this time and we get this opportunity to look at everything around us, see all these beautiful faces for those that are here inside of Zoom, and see all these reflections of us in a myriad of shapes and sizes and colors and vibrations. And we have to take just a moment, because this is the most important point, is that we've actually all come here together in unison, connected through unity and the ideals of unity, having a stable foundation underneath you, people that really care about you and care because they care about themselves, and they've learned that all is self, however long it takes you to figure that out. Now, if many remember that 13, 14 years ago, I wrote this book, and every single thing pretty much that you're hearing and seeing now, you can read a nice seed of that inside of that book, and that seed will sprout. It will let you look further, but it's not about telling you everything. It's about giving you the formula to do it all yourself. And so we're still doing that. We're still unpacking what was 60 billion years worth of knowledge and wisdom as it becomes applicable. Because as you know, at any point in time in life, what's most important is the awareness of what you're doing at that moment. And so we take this time and we take this opportunity to connect with each other and to say that we're counted and to touch this perpetual vehicle that we've created to connect it and let everybody know that if at any point in the past or in the future or even right now, if you feel like that it's not happening for you and that you're lacking, that this is the space to remember, because it will bring you abundance. Why? Because we put together the perpetual energetics. We bought the entire spectrum in the space. There's nothing missing. The starter is not missing, the alternator, the battery, the engine, the voltage regulator, every single part, the fuse box is here, present. And we want to give thanks for that. Now, also, there are quite a few more of these, and I never fail to mention that we've opened up many of these spaces through infinity so that you could touch base at any point in time. Wholeness. So here we go with just a little bit of a disclaimer for this evening. First, letting you know that I am not giving you any type of professional, legal, or medical advice with what I am telling you today. Meaning that if you go and do any of this, it's up to you and it's on you. Right? And so I want to make sure that that's known, because there is a lot of weird trolling going on these days. And when you've been in it for this long as I have, you've seen it all. And so I'm just letting y'all know, hey, it's your responsibility. So this knowledge and wisdom, this is A-level stuff. Like, I make sure that it's A-level stuff. So that means the potency is high. So if you're prone to depression, anxiety, and where you could get to a point where you don't know how to let knowledge empower you or truth bombs actually feed your arsenal, you may want to exit stage left and just go start with Eniology and build yourself up. It'll be the most instrumental thing that you can even do for yourself, is realizing the difference between a neophyte and an adept. No cockiness included. Like, it's great to start off at the beginning. Imagine you don't know anything about math, and they throw you in on trig. You over there acting like you just know everything, you know, which is kind of like the energy coming off a lot of people. I'll be like, well, keep that energy when it starts popping off. You know everything, right? You're doing it all yourself. And the fact of the matter is that we're not. We're everything. How are you doing it yourself? We're breathing, and breath is very powerful. But you'll notice the most powerful things will remain invisible to the blind person. The truly blind person, the most powerful things are invisible to them. Now, we know air, you know, without a moment of it, but you can't see it. So it's that simple fact of being aware that oftentimes the things that you cannot see are the most powerful and are affecting what is going on around you. And their power, their first power, is just that invisibility. Invisibility as a power is extremely, extremely useful. It gives you an extreme advantage. So this is an adept level transmission this evening. So I'm not going to start off with any pep talks. This was actually going to be a two-part session, meaning pep talks where we were actually going to have a sovereignty conversation this evening, which we've been building on. And this is just specific sovereignty in relation to legalese. And that was going to be the second half of our build. But after I started putting together what was generally the introduction, how we kind of, I go in first and then my brothers and sisters come in behind me with what they have to spread and share. And as I was writing this, because I haven't transmitted anything in at least 3 weeks, or three strongs, we call it, that this started building up. And this knowledge, you know, that's just how it works. It's like, I don't go to study anymore. I get these transmissions and little pieces, and I just take notes why it's all happening to me in real time. Then I also check on some of my brothers and sisters that are actually on YouTube that I know are also in that link. Like, that's how I know if somebody's telling the truth or not. Because if they're getting the same information as me, I know there's something's up. They on that Gnostic. They're tied into it. That's the people that when they're talking and you'll be like, yo, I was just talking about, he's thinking like me. Then you kind of get into this weird moment because you're like, well, who bought the, did I bring the knowledge? Did he bring knowledge? You're like, okay, let's not do this. There is a massive system. If you can imagine that having all of the knowledge in one moment, it's not necessary. What are you going to store all that on? Imagine knowing everything that ever happened and walking around with that. So our ancestors had a system where when they were in their most optimal state, they would just get the knowledge and the wisdom of what they needed at the moment in which they needed it. And when they didn't need it, they didn't access it, so that they can remain as clear and as focused as possible on what they were doing at that moment. I want to say, in everything you learn this evening, just remember that the mastery here was really a mastery over thoughts. It was that awareness that when you send your thoughts to so many different places, you're in all of those places. And when you can bring your thoughts to the moment, they're so powerful, they can actually manifest in the moment for anyone who can actually do that. And that's very rare these days. There's another rare thing. And it's here, especially, we are into balance, stability, and unity. So it's like after all of the wordplay and all the different things on different dimensions and different creatures running around and magical spells and all of that, I've made sure that I've gleaned the highest level of everything just to say, okay, and but this is what one needs to achieve. And it is summarized in balance. That's why you say wholeness and balance vibrations. It's right there. Stability, like I can't take off if I don't have a good foundation. Because if I take off, I can't land. If the foundation is crooked, I'm taking off crooked. So that stability in having a tribe really with you and beings that, you know, it's like, no cap. Like, this is what we are here to do. We're built for this. And then unity. Like, unity, man, it's one that probably takes the most. Because this is a very divisive plane that we're in. This is the division world. Everything is divided. Everything is divided from the next in order to express itself. But it's a paradox, too, because everything is connected. How confusing. But because of that, that whole unity thing can get blurry for people, and then they lose their power because you're everything. You just got to figure out what happened to you in that space and time, and why were you doing that at that variant of self? The masters, we know everything is unified. Everything came from a single source. That's my at. So if somebody wants to argue that, I got go ahead, man. I don't argue with fools. If you don't want to admit that we're in the dualistic and that's how everything looks all split apart, but still every single thing you're seeing, nothing excluded, is all unified in a certain space. So to me, these are the gems. Okay, so when you're talking about gems and all that stuff, these are the gems, balance, stability, and unity. And you know why? Because someone will try to steal that from you. At every moment, someone is trying to take you off balance, remove your stability, and divide you. That's how you know those are the gems, because every single person, they want it. No matter how much they over there doing the other thing or probably doing the opposite, they want those gems, and they will try to steal them from you by coming at you with the craziness, with the wedge, I call it, just to try to dig into your aura, dig into your field, get a hole going. You're hermetically sealed. That's what your ancestors put you in, a hermetically sealed vessel. But if somebody pop a hole in it, all of that power, all that compression, that fusion, all of that just starts leaking out everywhere. And, you know, things siphon up that energy and use it to power their vessels. This is what you would say is the open sea. And this is not about NFTs tonight. This is the open sea. You're in a world where anything can happen. But even more so, that's when you come out of the body, right? Because in the body, it's one thing, you know, that's like actually being in the port, maybe even on land in the body. But when you come out of the body, you're in the open sea. And you need nautics then. You need to really be aware of how to move your vehicle and what you're going to face in the deep. So tonight, I felt it important to talk about our family members, what they call the ancestors. Because it's not a moment that I don't tune into something and whoever's talking is just totally forgetting that we're talking about beings that we came from. And in many ways, we still are. That the responsibility still remains. You now wield the power. It's like the ball is in your court. You're conscious here and you're alive with all of this awareness, but all that phenomenal cosmic power, genie, and this itty bitty living space, you know, your little apartment on 3rd Street,
this pressure and this compression, this hermetically sealed vessel and all these troubles and tribulations that you feel that you're going through, this is your catalyst. It's the catalyst to do amazing things. Some of these folks, they were nothing, literally nothing before they got here. If you could say somebody knows you, you're sharing a message or something like that, you have a problem with Earth. Well, if it wasn't for Earth, nobody would know you. You came from nothing. You're nothing. So we have to remember that this position that we're actually in, having access to the astral plane, as long as you train yourself properly, and having access to the real world, if you may, the physical reality to really be able to slow it all down and live in the manifestation, this is the gift. But you will notice that as time drudges on, many will not see it as a gift anymore. They'll see it as a curse. It won't work for them. And that's the process of learning. That's the process of training. Like if you go to your great, great, great grandmother's house, is she acting like your mother, like how your mother raised you? Aren't they a little bit more tough? So a lot of this stuff that's happening is like happening because our ancestors is like hard bodies. So let me get into that. Let me get right into that. So this was loaded. So I literally had to take every single piece of what is here on these notes and just dial in. Okay. But I'm not going to admit anything. So we're literally saying we went from, let's just, for lack of better terms, we'll go to the singular because we're not going to try to explain the zero tonight. The singular to dual and multidimensional. So we went from a singular state of consciousness where everything is connected and operating as the thing, to not only dual, because we talk about this is a dual plane, and some people stop there. Now, dual plane did happen, but we kind of kept going. Now it's multidimensional also. You can holler at the duals, the trays, the quads. You can holler at all of the multidimensionals at this stage. The dual is very powerful because it starts something that pervades through the rest of it. If it wasn't for the dual, the three and the four and all that could not come, because the dual is the beginning of division. And just as it says, it's a dual. And what they tell you a dual is, it's like, on God, it's a dual. So we arrive on this dual plane. And I just have this one little layout here in my notes about some people just to ask the questions is, where were we before that? Or how did that start? I just want to entertain that just a little bit. More accurately, they say it was a yearning. Some say, so where did the first thing come from? Like, how did this all start? If we could ever express it, what would be the closest thing to it? And I could only say it was a yearning. It was like what had already happened started desiring to be. And it, as wild as that sounds, that's exactly why I don't generally play around too much in trying to explain the zone of where nothing came from. So I'm like to talk about what happened after that. They say the Scolex, also known as the worm, embedded itself into the dream of its own mother. You know, that's wild in itself. Again, that's the mother holding her son, but realizing that her son is also her husband because he has to come in and out of that womb consistently. They even show you the demiurge, lion-faced. Let's see if we got some imagery going on here. Lion face, right? It's just a worm. A Scolex embedding itself like a seaman, right? Going into the deep. And this is the core fundamentals of the phallus, the yoni, the whole process of creation, the basics. Some say that it started with a roar of confusion. not knowing where you came from, since something doesn't know where the beginning is and how to even comprehend that, that the roar began the world. That's why they say in the beginning was the word, and the word did not come back void. So the roar in the womb created the process that we're in right now. That's, you know, that's one point. They say that sound or words are penetrating. Our vibration or our tone in our tones are like probes themselves. And when they find something to nest into, they congeal. So they said this was a congealed creation, a clot, where light becomes condensed in a corner to form something dense. So I said, you know, play around with it a little bit. So that's the beginning, but that's not what we're here to talk about today. We actually got to fast forward because I felt like I needed to make this very relevant to what we're going through right now in 2022, and to make sure that the story, which is also called the Starry, which is already written, is told accurately, so that when you decide to rewrite it, you'll understand, you know, why reinventing wheels can become a problem. I mean, that someone will rewrite the story of existence, and you can't. But if you miss a key component or a key fundamental, it's not like you added or created anything or expanded anything. That's why this in this space, there's so many different things, because it's a summary. And so at this stage, I want to take you to a point of understanding how this popped off on what you're calling now a distorted or a negative level. Someone's like, well, why are we beefing? Why is there problems? Why is there traumas? Why is there sorcery and magic and sacrifices and all these kind of things? So I have to take you to a point of an escape. So you have to remember that things before us were, again, more congealed. So in every essence, everything was in a hive. And in a hive, there is one central processor. And when that central processor, whatever that central processor says, goes. This is the origins of God in itself, but it really was more of a goddess. It's actually hermaphrodite, but it's more positively female. Whatever it says goes. See, even the oracles or the sibyls on our planet, when they were here, they were tuning into that. They were tuned into that. They weren't it. They tuned into it. Well, we're all it. Let's put it that way. But it, if you, but they tune, you tune in. See, so there's a, let's say, a larger, more massive level of awareness that when you tune into, it'll tell you everything that's going to happen next, because it's already experiencing what's going to happen next. So it's all like just being in some type of time lag in a way where you can actually tap into the future and connect to the future and listen to the future and learn from the future and then come to the present and give that knowledge so that everybody can prepare for what's to come. And so in this space, the sibyls and the oracles were responsible for doing that in times that would look more familiar to you, even though the beings that lived at that point, your parents, your ancestors, you may not recognize them in the current body or mode that you're in right now, or mold that you're in right now. But the dramas and the things that took place then would still be more akin to what you recognize. So I want to start there. I want to start with a mother and what could be perceived to be very rebellious sons. And in this case, these sons have a desire to leave the hive. That hive mind creation that dictates what is going to happen, and it always happens, they decided that they wanted to leave that and write their own story. And that is the division of our people. I don't care what color you are. Colors, it's a joke. It's all a horrible, horrible joke. Taken too far, the rainbow and the spectrum. When beings start to imagine that they're not all connected to the same source. So if you notice in your occultism, there's always, I call them the usual suspects. You always see Pleiades and Taurus. You always see Sirius. You always see Orion. You always see Saturn. You always see Isis. You always see Osiris. And I'm explaining to you why that is like that right now, more specifically. But as I said before, if you can imagine when the sailors, and this is in the Wujua Quran, this is when the sailors sailed into this space, they were fleeing an entire empire where there was an empress and several empresses, if you may. And they were coming to create a replica so they can have their own world. And these worlds that they created is why you get that term, in my father's house, there are many mansions. Because at this stage, they have now completely erased all the data about the mother and her conduits, which were the sibyls and the oracles, especially at the Vatican. And this is why you're still today seeing the whole cult of Oannes, the whole cult of the mermaids, the whole cult even of Saturn or Satan living in the ocean. All the Africans know about this. We just look slow over here with our spirituality. The jinn and other life forms that actually exist on a parallel plane that match or balance out the physicalities of the bodies here, the elementals. So there's a whole thing going on. And here we are over here either trying to pick up the pieces to try to recognize or see what's going on, or even trying to create our own, never realizing that the same pieces that we're creating everything with is the same pieces that are already there. So it's just better to get the story clear. So now I got to, again, explain this in a way that we understand things. That's another thing, too, because it's interesting being on Earth, because even the way that we interpret how things are to make us understand it, it's not necessarily how it went. It's just like when you break something down for a child so that they can understand it in the language that they speak. So it was big beef. There was issues, problems. Sons wanted to create and wanted to get out of the preordained and predestined existences dictated by the Orion queens, which are every bit of reptilian. And what we can later on call the occult reptilian saga, just like everything going on in that. So they were breaking away from that. And what that required was, it required that they take the blueprint, which is actually DNA, it's an ME. That's why the tetragrammaton, or the number 26, is in the DNA. You could type it, YHVH in the DNA. So they needed to take a code, a base code, escape with that, and create another vacuum, another womb, and manifest a world. Now, you need to also understand that at this stage, the beings that we're talking about are hermaphroditic, even the males. So this whole idea of a male-female thing didn't come till way later on. And that's why I wanted to begin first by explaining. Well, actually, let me slow down. Let me show you where this is. Because somebody's like, well, how do you know? What are you talking about? Like, what are you saying? That the mother and the mother start fighting her sons? Or the sons was fighting their mother? It's in the stars. It's in the story. Orion's sitting right there in front of Taurus. And he's attacking. He's fighting his mother. And the fallout from that, as I said, the oracles were where the Vatican is. sent the sons all the way to where you're saying Egypt and where you're saying Samaria is to begin their own thing, taking the knowledge that they got from their mother about creating worlds. Now, also, when I say when I say the Vatican, what the Vatican is the Vatican is a space that's sitting right over the top of a portal. So anybody that is at in that space can hear what is going on in the future. So even now with the Jesuits in control of that space, they hear what's, it's just a portal. It's like literally a telephone there of transmissions from the future, vibrations of frequency from the future. And so any Sybil would be there in the state, picking up the frequencies and the transmissions and then delivering those edicts to the rest of the world. And every single culture was just acting into that knowledge because it was like 1,000% accurate. But again, that if you understand the space, you can see how some were questioning, like, what came first, a chicken or an egg? Is it accurate because they're saying it is? Are they abusing their power? Or just the sheer vigor of wanting to do what you want to do? The potency of the ancestors is already like, I'm trying to create my own and get out of this house. So this is what you're seeing when you're seeing Egypt, is you're seeing the enactment of the creation, the new creation process and the new refractions of light in order to create the world that we're actually in right now. So let me slow it down. Take a breath. This later on became known as the Orion projector. It's a projection. This actually, I think, is someone put this together. I believe that's Neil Haig. So there was also an occult image that I have of this, like an old image. And I found pieces of it. I was looking for like 30 minutes. And I was like, okay, I got to move on to something else. But I have a video about this, and it's called Proof We're in an Illusion. And it's an old diagram, and it pretty much shows this same thing. That somehow and in some way, light is refracted from all of the from the major system all the way to the minor systems to actually create multiple holographic worlds. But you talk about how in the realm of, we could say, quote unquote, the goddess, it looks like an hourglass. Well, so does Orion. Orion has this shape of an hourglass. So it's a mimicry using lights, because when we say the word illusion, like what I talked about, people say, hey, this is an illusion. Illu means light to us. So the S-I-O-N, like you see on the back of mansion, you see mansions, illusions. So S-I-O-N, that's Sion. What does that mean? It's basically world, spaces. This is simple ciphering. So the illusions are the houses of light. And that's just a metaphor of saying that all these realms and dimensions are created off of tones and vibrations, but specific tones and vibrations. It should be very clear, like, this is a created world. So some stars are not here. Some stars are not in the sky. Some things have been moved around. Some things have been changed. And the ones who govern that are known as the watchmen. So how this works is like what they call fiber optics. This is why technology, as I mentioned, is just a mere replica of the spiritual world. You can oftentimes figure out things about spirituality easier through technology now, because, you know, they still got everybody thinking that they created the technology. And the reality is that the technology is a plagiarization of the spiritual world. So they just have stuff in store to get to the world at a certain point and act like they create whatever, whatever. But it's all coming from how the spiritual world has always operated. And it's very similar to fiber optics. So we started using fiber, what was that?
We started using optical inputs only for a short period of time with our stereo systems and speaker systems. They were glass cables. They would break really easy, and they were expensive. And that's why they phased it out. I still have like 20 of them in there because I used to like, yo, this whole idea. And you look down the cable, and you see only light. But many don't know that one strand, which is as thin as a hair, one strand of the modern fiber optic cable can conduct half of the conversations of the world to the other half of the conversations of the world at the same time. That is how much bandwidth is in fiber optics. But that's a mere replica of exactly the same strands and exactly the same strings that you as a human being, or beyond actually, are connected to on multiple realms and multiple dimensions, right? That all these different strings are all different thoughts that you connect into, and all your data is down all of those lines. So that's what I was saying about the whole mini mansions thing, because it gets into just that when you start something like that, it becomes what we now know today as a Taurus. There are many masters on the internet that is just, you know, like the level of awareness. You know, like, shout out to my brother Sanchez, like the level of the awareness that's coming across the space. It's like, man, the gig is up. All secrets have been revealed, either through Gnosticism or leaked documents or symbolism deciphered. It's all here now. But now it's like, so what are we going to do with it? And so I just wanted to come into space and just kind of itemize this level of awareness so that we can get the best of the experience. Let me get some water. Hold on. I have my water over there. We want to optimize and get the best of the experience. In fact, I think I'm gonna take a moment, but I'm just gonna go real quick and refresh myself. Like I recommend that you do it too. Just go refresh yourself real quick, and you know, because that's what it is. It's about always taking the moment and taking the time to gather yourself and what you're experiencing when you're going on real journeys. Okay, so I'm gonna take a moment real quick. I personally have to just go and empty some water. To get my high frequency pressurizing system together. So we talked about introducing ourselves once again to the family members so that you can see the whole scene. Because sometimes we expect so much from the primordials. It's like we'd be expecting everybody to be perfect but us, right? Like nobody makes mistakes. And since the projection started as a work in progress, meaning that when the sons of Orion came to the daughters of men, they had no experience at all about creating worlds. That was the whole thing that you see with Cain and Cain being born from Adam and Eve. It meant that in every story that you'll see, the firstborn is generally a little jaded. And it shows that, hey, the whole creation process is not something that really anybody knew how to do when these worlds got created. It was like almost even like a unsanctioned act. Okay? And so the temperaments of our ancestors is really the explanation of why we're in the reality that we're in and why it's like this. So I just want to run through a few of them as far as their dossier. So we have ancestors that
basically have thousands of years of memory. Like, okay, so in this life, we have 72 years, right? And for most people, they have access to that. And by the time that they start getting 70, they start, or even before then, they start forgetting about everything. And they even start going back up into baby mode again and, you know, all of that. Like, and also, if you've ever been through some crazy stuff in life, you have a tendency to not really want to remember those things all the time because they bother you. They disturb you. Right. So at the end of the day, that's just 10, 20, 30, 40 years. And you're already dealing with that. So imagine thousands of years. Thousands of years. See, the reason why a lot of people don't even have access to all their memory banks is because they can't handle it. It's like bipolarity and schizophrenia at the same time. You would just watch the person melt and disintegrate right before your eyes, seeing things that you can't see, experiencing things that you can't feel, just like when a person goes on a journey. If all of it was loaded at once. So we call that the degrees, literally. Like, how much of that Kundalini coil or DNA can the person handle being unlocked? Because if you uncap it, as it's called, just uncap the bandwidth, everything's just going to come flooding in and you're just going to see an expression or a look. And you're not going to get words or anything anymore. So we just need to realize, though, that our ancestors, they were equipped to, they were like capacitors. Actually, you know, many don't know, but many of the ancestors are actually stone. They are the stones. There's like big giant stones, deep stones deep in the ocean. Even what you're seeing with the quote-unquote pyramid, all this stuff is just pieces of bodies. Those are the bones and the stones, okay? And it's because they're like placeholders themselves. Even in the realm that they're in, they don't appear like stones, but here they do because the vibration and the frequency makes them basically like slow here and stone-like, like they're not moving. Versus on in their dimension, they're accurate. I mean, and active. That's how the planes work. Okay? So you got these memory banks, right, that contain all of the data, all the way through the Orion Wars, the conflicts of the suns, because you always see right off early, it starts popping off between two of the suns. Some call it Allah and Alalu. Some call it Osiris and Set. Some call it Cain and Abel. But it's in every story that the sons start beefing. And this happens for sure because in many ways that many of the things that they needed to stabilize themselves, they no longer had. And that's like the security and the foundation of their mother. Okay, so they abandon their stability, their launch pad, their spaceport, right, for this endeavor. So of creating a new world, okay? So also, when we think about DNA, we know that there's a one-strand DNA. You go research it yourself. Reptilians have one strand of DNA. They don't have the two-strand DNA, let alone a three-strand DNA. Now, the 12-strand DNA, you know, okay. You know, I'm not going to throw any light workers off right now, but three strands is pretty much all you need, right, to conduct through the system. And I'll explain why. But a single strand DNA is very interesting as a state of consciousness. Sometimes you will find it. They call it the reptilian side of your brain. These are warrior clans. So while humans are over here with the whole love thing, they are on the fear and hate thing naturally. And that may confuse you because that's different than how you live, even though you'll see some people that they seem to be a little bit more like that. And it's because it's in their DNA. But it's just that the worlds are juxtaposed. So while one being loves to hate, another being loves to love. So, you know, Michael Jackson say, you know, are you a lover? I'm a lover, not a fighter, okay? And we talked about that here in Ambassador Train, but we'll explain it to YouTube. Like, the word love is a cognate of the word Taurus. There's a whole breakdown of that. Destin will package that up, and I'll send it out as the next video because I was like, man, I wonder if they have that whole build of how the word love is really a Taurus, right? And then we have a fighter, which is fight, which is phi, which is a pentagram. So you would basically, in the end of the day, if you understand the Taurus actually ends up blowing out to like a Sri Yantra or six-pointed system, you would have a 6 and you would have a 5. You would have a lover and you would have a fighter. And if you look at in any societies, they encode 6 and 5 into everything. But it is a dualistic plane because 6 and 5 equals 11. And then there you have the 2 there again. So you have basically a mating of the dualistic forces. And that was the design within itself. Okay. And so those who hold up that side that we would say is disagreeable, they're always trying to scare everybody. Like even a trip on the astral plane around them, everything is trying to scare you. And you eventually gain a thicker skin to not be afraid, but it's something they all do. And when you, if you can't recognize this, go look at the tribe, it's called the Maori tribe. What is all of that? Look at the African tribes. You're like, what is all of that? Because they're trying to scare you. Fear is how they move and how they thrive because they are fire. See, it's strength. It's like watching wolves, baby wolves. They're fighting, biting each other and all this kind of stuff. And you're like, you be over there like, rock-a-bye, baby. Home the street town. Oh, you're so cute. Right? So just peep out the dualities, though. And as I'm saying, what I'm doing here is I'm just giving you an idea of the temperaments of your parents. So that way, or the ancestors. So that way, when we're starting to see all the things that ends up popping off later, it's not like so surprising to us that all this is going on. And we feel like we're in some kind of this trap and all this stuff that, you know, it's like life is what you make it. So if it's too much for you, you can't handle the degrees. They say you can't handle the heat. You need to get out of the kitchen. This place is basically, they call it the potter's house, right? The potter's house meant you go to the kiln first at some point. The moment you get molded, now you're put into the fire. The whole body is like a blazing fire. That's what Phi is. You see humans on the spiritual plane, if you've ever been there, everybody's like a blazing light. But that light can go dimmer and dimmer. That light can become cold even. That's why sometimes when certain entities are around, everything just gets super cold. But this is the real spiritual quest. It's the difference. It's a difference between reading what others are saying, listening to what others are saying, divining some stuff, but then there's doing it or seeing it or being engaged. So that way it's like a confirmation. I can tell you about these things because I had to go on those journeys and go on those experiences. And as I said before, you'll still be like the next day on the city bus. Just because you can get out of the body, just because you know about other life forms and all that, doesn't exempt you from normal life. I had a note for the end of this conversation. Don't be surprised if you have to figure out how to live on multiple worlds, at least 2, to know how to position yourself in these different spaces that you're embedded in. So going on with the ancestor, that reptilian side is also very prideful. This is actually the pride that they talk about that comes before destruction. They talk about the reptilians. The pride thing is at an all-time high. So right off, you're dealing with a warrior clan, and you're dealing with very prideful beings that basically inspire through fear. And these are like the jinn in themselves, right? And that's just a part of what human beings are mixed with. Then we have the hermaphrodites. So the hermaphrodites, as I was explaining before, these are the sibyls themselves. These are the oracles themselves. These are the gnomos themselves. They are sovereigns in every single right. So their whole mentality, see, they're self-generating. They're self-substantiated. So all of the dependency on other things is not them at all. Anything that seems like it's going to be that is moved out of the way. This is like a woman that doesn't want a man on top of her. Let's put it that way. It's like... This is why the ocean is connected to sovereignty. This is why the ocean is different than the land. This is why they out there and we're over here. And every now and then there's a Montague and Capulet marriage. And that's pretty much it. Because they maintain their sovereign way of being inside of the empires in which they're in. Okay? So, but again, because you have these volatile components all in this same space, then you can start looking at the reality truly and saying, okay, well, this is why they were doing that 100 years ago or 1,000 years ago. Or this is why things are like they are right now, why there's bad blood, as they call it. That's when somebody doesn't want to get over what may have happened in the illusion. what could have ended your last game. Then they start taking it too seriously. And that's why the masters always say that when you're so they explained it perfect, that when you see something, so they hold their beads up, and I wish I had a pair of my beads, there's somewhere around here. They hold their beads up and they say that when you see something that you like, try not to pull it towards you. Okay, because if the beads are here and you like something, so you want to pull it towards you. I gotta have that. I want that. What happens is you pull it this way, and then eventually it has to swing back, so it leaves. And they say likewise that things that you are trying to avoid, try not to pull it away from you, because as you pull out here, it eventually come back and then hit you in the face. So this is a metaphor for basically understanding how energy actually works. That's why some people, they end up attracting the things that they don't want and all that goes on, because it's about the consciousness and how the consciousness is maneuvering. Now, the total goal of all of the mixing that's going on, even between the hermaphrodites, the reptilians, the djinns, et cetera, is actually to create a more refined being. That doesn't always happen, though. It's also in intentions, because like when they created sugar, sugar is even worse than sugar cane, if you may. You see what I mean? So secondary creations or third, fourth, fifth creation could be worse than the originals. So this process of refining through basically combinations and the generations of more don't always turn into exactly what you want them to turn into. It's kind of like the Frankenstein story. The more you alchemically mix certain things, sometimes you're just alchemically mixing them to get a certain trait refined. Not that the whole is perfect at all, but now you can isolate that trait and then continue the process of refinement. So while we have spent all of this time in our existence pretty much looking at technology and trying to figure out the applications with that, there are thousands and thousands of years of our ancestors looking over the biological inner workings of everything and understanding how to work with that. And in that process, it is known that the issue with one-strand DNA, if you can say there is an issue, you would definitely never get a reptilian to admit that there's an issue. I just want to put that out there for you, is that there's no floating point. So how we understand it is the Pingala, right? So we have the Sushumna, the Pingala, and the Ida, right? So that's like three channels. So imagine just having one channel. And what that does is it kind of prevents you from scaling the ladder, because you don't have that floating point. And the easiest way to explain this is that everything is so hierarchical in that state of consciousness. It's like that same being has that same position forever. And that's what I was saying that some of the suns were running from, is that they were fixed stars in themselves and they became wandering stars. So it's just that awareness that what DNA is DNA is the ability to switch channels. So if you have a positive and a negative, you have a Sushumna, you can jump over to the other frequencies. That's why they say, behold, I saw the ladder going up and down. That's the DNA. When someone says they can raise themselves from the dead and come back to life, that means that they can go up and down the ladder, that they can go to the astral plane and then they can come back to the real world, or what you were saying is the real world, okay? But with only one strand of DNA, it's so difficult to do that. It's not like a natural thing, and that's what makes that race, if you may, different than us. That's what makes the djinn different than human beings. It almost makes us opposites in that way. This is not an in every case thing, but it is a majority thing. So again, I was also just allowing you to see the temperaments here. The word is temperament of the ancestors, because their elemental mixtures, right? So they have a certain kind of alchemical or elemental mixture versus yours is, you know, you got a whole spread in there. Now, again, it doesn't always work out well. But even the idea of a cyclops is one eye. right? Not two eyes, one. And in that, again, there's no floating point. There's no Sushumna. No ability to traverse the realms. No ability to come into life and also into death and be conscious, or that be, or it be voluntary. A person can voluntarily kill themselves. We call it go to sleep. And then we can wake back up. So just peep out the advancement. So the other thing that we want to talk about is the zones, okay? Because at a certain stage, it's already known. It's just like the thing about the ocean. That there's zone, these beings have zones and territories. That became the dimensions. This is hidden in the Bible about Shem, Ham, and Japheth, which are actually three different types of beings even, being told that they should spread themselves out into the land. Okay? And this is because elementals, this is the primordial powers, when they're next to each other, it's like having fire inside of water or any of the opposing elementals. Some are more akin to each other, if you may, or akin to each other, while others are almost like opposites. So in the world, all the divisions, and in the cosmos, if you may, all the divisions are actually based on that. It's based on temperaments and vibrations. And that's why it's easy for you to get into a certain world by vibrating the frequency of that world. And our ancestors did have it so refined that they had rituals that they performed over and over and over again. Somebody had that job to do that. So that way, if anyone performed that ritual, they would just go right to that space, because that frequency had been done so many times, it would just call in that space to wherever you were. So it's repetition. The whole of this magic, quote unquote, used here on Earth, it's just repetition. So these zones and territories of the elementals became the divided lands respectfully. Now I can comfortably say that 9 is a good number, because 9 is how many donuts you have in a complete Taurus. 9 is actually what you see in Enneology or the Enneagram. 9 is what you have also in Egypt. So there's a consensus that 9 is the number, if you may, of these different realities and realms. You can call them chakras, right? Here in this world, they love to focus on the 7 a lot. The reality is that there's two more colors, black and white. The absence of color is clear. Okay, it kind of should make sense, but it doesn't always make sense that black and white themselves as concepts are also rolled into the polarities of colors. Versus if you wanted to be a clear being, what we used to call clear face. Now that's something different entirely. So you have fear and hatred in these realms juxtapose with love, if you may. And we talked about that, being the marker or the compass of how you're navigating these spaces. So in all essence, the world is not round. It's not triangular. It's not flat. It's whatever you make it. Because when you start vibrating a certain thing, that space just dials in to wherever it is that space, that geometry, that ideal. So that's why, like you'll see in Rosicrucianism, there's many that just move through Platonic solids in geometry. They move through the geometry, through the spaces, because the created worlds, if you may, are created from those geometrics. And being able to move your HUD or your third eye into that lattice field allows you to then be perceptive of that space, which is all meshed in right over this space too. So you'll be out in the jungle and you can see all of the entryways and passageways to other spaces, because you now have that HUD, if you may, over your eyes. So this is how the eyes are controlling the dimensions and the perceptions of the dimensions. And this, of course, is also connected in with the DNA, because if a person is unlocking certain fields or channels, then they unlock that geometric level of awareness and visuals primarily within their pineal gland, okay? So again, the markers and the compasses of how you're navigating these spaces are primarily still based on your attitude. That's what's dialing in these frequencies. So this is why you have certain animals, because the animal kingdom will, you know, really deliver lots of insights, because humans were actually created. This model of humans was actually created. The body was actually created from many of their components. So you have animals that love, and then you got animals that terrify. And if you watch the animal kingdom, you'll see that there's a clear demarcation between these two different types of animals. So, as I said, you have lovers and fighters. But you also got to remember that the baby of anything is cute. I'll say it again. The baby of anything is cute. Like, if you're a giant, basically, and you can even see one of the most fearsome beasts, this baby, and he'll just be like, and you'll be like, right? But it's only when it's, like, super huge and tearing shit up that you're like, okay, this is evil. So it's just one of those demarcation points to remember that most beings here are like children compared to the ancients. So being a threat is not really where they're at. It's more of like, oh, okay, that's cute. So I just, in understanding this, these tones and these vibrations of the different energies that are around us, that's what I was saying, like, we expect so much from them, but don't want to deliver anything. It's like people will be on YouTube complaining about the financial system and stuff, like it's up to somebody else to fix it for them. They'd be like whining about not having something, but they have access to the entire library. They're complaining about technology on their phone. They're talking about, you see what I mean? So this is called double-mindedness. Either you're in or you're out. Either you're with it or you're not. But if you're not one or the other, then you're kind of betwixt. And this is also the state that many people find themselves in the world, is that they hate the reality. That's why we're saying it's like we have a problem with our past. We have a problem with what happened. And we don't even want to acknowledge what happened so we can even get through it. We just bring that hate and division into everything that we do. And this is how we function until we learn the lesson. So I'll tell you this. Anytime you show up in a world and these two guys are here, expect for it to pop off. I'll say it again. If you show up in a world and these two guys are here first, expect for it to pop off, because they hate each other. They be trying to actually remove each other forever. And I just want to take a moment for this, because, you know, I have to break the ice on everything. It's like, because I'll be like hanging on every word. Well, I don't believe that that's necessarily true, Seven. And I believe it's okay or whatever. Okay, do what you do. I'm going to do me. This is how I see it. This is my perspective of things since I've been in the world now. What's coming on 44 years here on the 22nd. Okay, so I know for sure when I look at some of the big problems that we're dealing with in the planet is because we got two forces that are always locked in a battle with each other. Now, the issue is now is that they've kind of even consolidated their warfare and start attacking everybody else. Now, again, this is like the disturbed uncle. For real, because remember, all the family members ain't cool. Like, it's just that way. Just remember that there's that drunk uncle or that warlike cousin. And what happens is that when that starts to speak for everyone, though, when they start to broadcast that on all the radio waves and down all the portals of fiber optic knowledge, then it just gets like a buzzkill for everybody else who knows the power of being able to go in and out of the world, to be able to take it up and down, where death does not really exist. It's actually one of the most craziest creations, because it's impossible. But yet here in this realm, it actually exists. And I'm just speaking directly to that. There is this polarity thing going on where we constantly have one side wanting to utterly destroy the other side. And we have to admit that there is some stuff written that they have said that they want to remove all the black people. And likewise, there are some black folks that have been like, we may be better off without the white folks. And that is pretty much the tone of the vibration of this kind of energy of when the two sons start to battle it out over what is here on the planet or here in the existence. And then you got to go ahead. You got to live through that. Your mother's got to live through that. Your children got to live through that. And what happens to them over hundreds and thousands of years? What happens to their DNA? How they start seeing things, especially since every single thing that we used to have is blown up or in rubble. Like they call it like the wonders of the world. Go look at them. They all look like they're not that wonderful. Nobody is actually doing any scaffolding. You know, we could rebuild this stuff. We got the technology, but no, it's got to look like it's over. We blew it all up. We don't like each other anymore. And that pervades. And I'm going to show you why. And why also that's going to change. But just remember, so coming from the dualistic, okay, coming from the dualistic or the singular to the dualistic, you will still be able to catch a glimpse of the singular within singular things on your body. So if you want to know the power of the singular, look at things that are still singular on your body. Like you have one pineal gland. Your brain is not singular. You have two hemispheres. Your eyes are not singular. There's one there, the pineal, that's singular, right? Your nostrils, right? There's two holes, two ears, two hands. Because these are all the dualistic components. When they're building Frankenstein, they build the components like this because you will literally be in conflict. Like your soul will be in conflict with your body. Your body will want to do things, and we've talked about this, your body will want to do things that will come directly contrary to what your soul feels like it wants to do. So in fact, also, your body will start to do things that will even hamper your states of awareness. So it's almost like these two are in a conflict. And it's because the spirit world, or some would call that astral plane, some would even call that the nethers, right, is in conflict with the physicals. So we got singulars, right? There's a few singular components. If you look on your body, there's a singular component. Right? There's a very powerful singular component on the male and the female's body. But then even that component will have a dual component on it. So it's just that awareness of what is the singular or sacred powers versus what are the dualistic powers. But here it is, though, because they used to call it, again, they call it a chariot. That you're on the chariot. So why you want to complain about all this? Because it can get out of control. This would be the same thing as you getting out of, you complain about that all your horses are running in different directions. All your manes or all your powers, you can't control them anymore. Now they're controlling you. Now they're telling you what to do. Now you're so deep into the illusion of something that something else created that you can't even recognize where you are in that anymore. This is not going to stop. This is something that you actually have to get in control of. Or it's going to be going on infinitely. Some people think that when they die, it's going to end. It ends the moment you make it end. It ends the moment that you take over the frequencies and actually say, well, this is where we're going today. This is where we're going with this. So let's keep going. I will tell you, though, warning. Relationships are about relating, and they end when you can no longer relate. Again, relationships are about relating, and they end when you can no longer relate. So when you can no longer relate to what is going on in this space, you will be removed from this space. Make no mistake. So just make sure you know where you're going. When there's no more of this that we're complaining about so much and hate, just make sure that you got another one to go to. Some have come to the conclusion that they do, so I trust that they do. But in relationships, because that's what we're actually in right now. Like many people don't realize that we impregnated Earth. So now we're here, we're in a relationship, and we're having a hard time working it out. Just like immature people all the time on this realm, always fighting. Look at the relationships, look at the fallout, look at the children. It's the same story. Now it's everybody else's fault but ours. Who's going to come in and put this back together? So I know that there's a primary responsibility for me to do that first for myself. I have to come in and make heads or tails of it. That's why I go into history. That's why I look at in history. That's why I look at my ancestors. That's why I accept the things that they have done. And instead of being like, and they are against me and they hate me and all that, it's like, man, my grandma walked 60 miles a day to go pick up water. I have a car right now. So I'm still trying to figure out how can I be so downtrodden and so upset and acting like that this existence is so against me when I know that her life was much more difficult than mine. And if I was really looking at things soberly, I would say that this has been progress. Now, of course, there are going to be some that they want to start in the mansion. They want to start with all the riches, all the wealth, all the knowledge. But I'm telling you, they'd be the same ones that can't handle it. They want to fly, read other people's minds, throw lightning around like a Sith Lord, knowing damn well that if it's a 2,000-3,000 people fawning after them, they're going to corrupt under all of that. They can't even handle the power. So it's just about looking at the experience, looking at the history, looking at her story, and look at what's going on, and then actually dealing with it, putting your hands in it. That's what I believe that we're encouraged to do. So in this stage in time, let me show you this. Because we got to get like some kind of timeline, right? So let me pull up something I was laughing about because I couldn't even really find something else that looked better. I just kind of had to laugh at it. I was like, forget it. You know, we'll go with it because I'm just trying to prove a point. So let's just imagine. Let me throw this up here. So you could take any chart, any story, any timeline. We'll just use this one for today. This one just happens to be the, according to the scripts, the chronological rollout of the deities in Egypt, okay? And we're just going to use this as like a crude timeline, okay? So we're saying one level, two levels, three levels, four levels, five, six, seven, eight, and nine. So I wish I had one of those things that you just go, you are here. So basically, again, any timeline will look similar to this, but what I'm trying to get across here is that if all of this kind of went on before us and we're all like products of it, no matter what it is, you could imagine that we're a combination of all of these things, right? I mean, I just think this kind of stuff is common sense, but you really have to kind of dial in. And as I said, some may not like the pantheon and the names of the gods and all that, and I definitely feel you like it gets a little weird at times, but I'm just using this as a diagram, and I'm saying that probably the most instrumental part of any of this that you would need to know about is actually this particular segment in time, right? This particular code in the program. Because what this actually is, if you understand what the ancestors were doing, is these are codes. These are codes generally fed into the mainframe of Edfu and would dial in this kind of reality in the actual fields that everyone was existing in the space, right? And this code specifically, I'm saying, is pretty important because it has to do with actually everything that you're experiencing around you in physicality right now. So let me just break this down and build it back up really quick, okay? We're saying this is basically a generational chart, a very crude one. Nonetheless, it's useful because it gives us an idea of how many layers are in the cake. Here we have Men, Isis, Osiris, Nephthys, and Set. This, if it was a code, would clearly be an age of male fertility and sexual potency based on the code. Because Osiris is, in a nutshell, the netherworld and the world of sleep, also called Nod. Right? So these are the Cain went to the land of Nod on the east of Eden. That's the netherworld. Osiris is known as the god of the netherworld. Let's just try to put these codes together. Then we got Set. right? So Set is the god of war, which is also working. Okay, some people forget that. Working is war because companies are battling each other. You put on a war, you go to the wardrobe every day, and then you dressed for what's about to happen at the job, okay? And when you know what war is, you understand that war is deeply in tune with science. So Satan, as you would know him, is or it is, or as a vibration, a war god that uses science, working, and that kind of stuff, right? Then we have Nephthys. And Nephthys' story is... Nephthys' story is it's interesting because it's... When you think of now, like, you know, some of our sisters, they're kind of losing it. I just have to say what it is. I'm not going to go fresh and fit on y'all, but I'm just saying our sisters, they're not as abundant as they used to be, right? So there's a barren kind of death energy over the divine feminine. That's Nephthys, if you understand the story. Then we got Isis, right? Now, remember, these are vibrations. So you want to see them as human beings because that's like, we can make clay figures now for the humans to understand what's going on. But these are codes. And when codes like this are laid out like cards, this is the game and this is how it's dealt. This is the house, okay? So then we have Isis. So Isis is the goddess of magic, right? And magic, in this case specifically, if you understand the text, is referring to magic of laws. Invisible laws and money. That's why Isis is compressed as a dollar sign, right? Because so this thing about manipulation of money through laws and paper. The papyrus of Isis and the works of the papyrus is the key fundamentals to how this magic with a K in their case happens. And it's all hidden. And that's what the whole thing about the sovereign law and all that stuff is really about, is decoding all this stuff going on in the legalese system, not just to go and cash your birth certificate in and try to pay off your house debt, but to actually really figure out how is this construct really working? Because I'm going to reveal something very deep here about what went on between Osiris and Set and what they ultimately agreed to after the last text that was written, which was their conflict. But we'll keep going on, and we'll also mention that Men is here, which it's funny because Men is like the least known player at this stage. You will almost neglect that Men was there at all if you didn't understand the code. But Men is there at this line of the code, and what Men is amplified. This word Men does not refer to males. If it did, it wouldn't be on the back of woman. Think about it. If man only referred to us as man, it wouldn't be on the back of woman. It's man is men. Men is amplified abundance, basically like what you see with trees. Like when the tree has so much fruit on it, that's because there's a fecundating component that is there. And in these matrixes, they love to add generally the green man, or actually what you would call the masculine fecundating component as a seed. Okay, so this just means in code that now all of this from the netherworld and sleep, lands of Nod, wars, businesses, companies, science, death, and barren lands like deserts, like how stuff that used to be on fleek looks now, like it's just deserted because the divine feminine is not there. It's barren. It's covered up, right? And then all that amplified, okay? So just so you understand the code, because when you understand the code, you can always then, all of the entities, and this is why they were saying that every entity has its opposite. That's what supposedly Solomon was always trying to figure out was, so what is the opposite of that? So they would call a demon and get the demon to reveal what angel thwarted him. This is a vibrational frequency thing. It's the awareness that on the Taurus field that there is an opposing force on each side of the Taurus field. And if you know those opposing forces, like noise cancellation, you can cancel it out and get into the center. That was the goal. That was the knowledge. That was the awareness. But the knowledge and the awareness played out through polarities. And it's very important to realize that the polarity game was the game of all games. That there couldn't be a way of expressing something without the other thing also being there. That was a counteraction to it. So as I mentioned before, when we entered into this stage, or when Osiris decided and set decided, if you may, these are codes that, hey, we'll split this thing. You handle the world, the reality, the physical world, and I'll handle the nether world, right? Because at this point, these two suns as an energy become jaded in many ways. Like, there's a lot of jaded things that have happened in our history where all of the beings, even the children, were enslaved. This is something that is just, it's known that children became the marker. Children became themselves the currency, and parents would sell their children to jinn. Parents would sell their children to other lands and other masters. Parents would sell their children generations into the future to other entities and lords and all types of stuff. So it went to that. It got to that. And again, in a realm of juxtaposition, it gets to that so that we understand why we wouldn't want that, why we wouldn't want our children to live through that. And then when we birth children, if we're given that responsibility, we then raise them and not do that to them. That's how it all gets worked out in the DNA. It doesn't get worked out with the blame game. I mean, what goes on is kind of obvious. Like, again, you get a vibe like Lord Mayor Rothschild, who treated all his children like shit. Look at what's going on over here. Make sure nothing's going on. Okay, so yeah, treating everybody like, you know, treating the children like, you know, they're just bargaining chips. Okay, so in Saturn's world, the jaded Saturn in this case, so let me just explain it just from an identification level. This world is sitting in a layer of the ocean. So all the nether regions, this is all nether world stuff, by the way. This world that was built was, as I said, a work in progress. So the higher realms that you go into beyond this world, they just get more and more perfect. That's what you're really dealing with. So when you're going up to Sushumna, which is like an elevator sitting in the center of a shaft, and you're going all the way up, it just gets more and more refined. You eventually enter worlds that there's definitely not a physical object, and there's definitely not a lot of energy there, if you may, because it starts going into what we would call the motionless. So all energy, tones, vibrations, and frequencies are not really present. I can't tell you I've been into that space, but I can tell you for sure as you start going up, you realize, hey, I'm headed there. Maybe I'll chill out for a minute, because you realize for sure as an adept that in there, you wouldn't even be able to access who you are anyway to think about returning here. Okay. So if somebody wants to go there, just understand that place does exist. You would never know any more about who you ever were or what you ever did or any of that. That's the motionless space. That's why I said many were nothing before they came here. And so if you're here at all and you're appreciating notoriety or people that know you or you love somebody or whatever, what is the big deal? Because you wouldn't have that all any at all if you weren't here. I just want to make that very clear, because this is the kind of space that stuff like that exists. But as I said, because that exists, now we got to deal with all of the rest of that. What if somebody wants more of that, wants more notoriety, wants more power? And you had kings like that or cons, and they're always in the space. These are what were called also the sovereigns. In fact, one of the vessels they built was the moon. Many of them sit in the moon, right? So if you can imagine the moon cut in half, looks like an orange, and that every receptacle, there's a being laying in the receptacle, like a sarcophagus. And every time the refractor hits that part of the sarcophagus, all of the energy from that being sprays into the earth. And it keeps going around it and keeps spraying. So that's how the coding system works, right? So this is a craft. So this kind of technology is what you would say is really advanced compared to what the world is doing, where the world is still in this phase of acting like it's figuring out what the potential is even of the spiritual plane. Still has yet to admit that there is a spiritual plane. This is comical, the state that the world is being dumbed down into, but yet Saturn's kingdoms in these layers of the ocean are still completely active. All the technology, as is known, Africans know about this, be looking at everybody like they stupid. All the technologies that we're using here and the clothes and the fashion, the makeup, the swag, the drip, the music, all Saturn stuff. The workers of Saturn, it's the work became warfare. So this is what happened. So before, when Saturn and Osiris divided the world, Saturn roamed through the land and went to war with everything. That's what you're actually seeing in the Bible. Old Testament is Saturn running around, destroying all the tribes, asking for obeisance from everything, and let's go kill them, set up this there, set up this religion, set up this. So that's all Saturnalian stuff. And people are still in, like, there's a lot of people that have heavy damage from that in their DNA. They just love to worship. They love to jump in that warship and fight everybody inside that warship. Okay, so the whole Saturnalian, when the Saturnalian thing came into the world, it basically set everything up perfectly for Osiris, because when you died in warfare, you definitely weren't going to a high vibration. Do you understand? So it was like, I'll throw them to you. Once they stop, once they stop battling each other and realize that there was potentially a bigger prize for them, they consolidated and divided things and said, okay, well, you, Saturn, Satan, Seth, you handle the work, jobs, which later on became jobs, corporations. Before, it was handling the warlike tribes of Earth and getting them to play like toy soldiers and keep clashing with each other so that they would end up in the realm of Osiris. And because of the burdens and the testimonies against them, meaning the organs would testify against them, every single thing that they had been doing that life would testify against them and cry from the earth against them in the halls of Osiris, which was like a courtroom. This is where the whole thing started, with the courtroom and the weighing and all this kind of stuff, right? And then it was already decreed that, you know, for a person who knows nothing else but warfare, barely even knows love or anything, you're going to go to a hotter stage of the oven. And in these stages that in the netherworld, you become more and more confined, just so you understand, since everything, let's say, going that way is potentially being free more, no body, no this, no that, no, you know, so you're just expanding further. There's another one where you just keep contracting, contract, debt, all these things, clothes, all these things, right? Custom, right? Borders, boundaries, all this kind of stuff. What's, again, setting up this world that, again, people were going into because they were constantly leaving this space with that ill mindset of a verse, a conflict. Okay, so this is how Osiris and Set ran their world. And when it became like, okay, well, I think it's kind of thwarting them to keep killing them or having them die like this. And we cannot build this world that looks like Gaia Sophia's, because they were always still looking at their mother world. Now remember, the mother's world is still active right now. Like, y'all be like over here crying about Gaia. This is the urn. Like, this world was known to be predominantly a masculine world. This is not the owl of the Amazon. There's a replica of it here, but the female world, if you may, of the goddesses is still untouched. It's still a virgin. But here, though, this is where it all plays out. So let me gather myself. Okay, so what I was explaining is, again, so you had, at this stage, you had Osiris and Set agreeing that the war thing needed to kind of chill out a little bit. Now, they still haven't, you know, you can't tell the god of the war not to fight anything, right? So wars are going on now. But the biggest war is in the corporation. The biggest war is work itself. Because then every human being pretty much was then tasked to work. And that became the new war, because when you're working, you're also not really having enough time to get into who you are. And just like that, the whole process from cradle to grave again, working to retirement, barely have enough energy, then die. Here comes Osiris. And most people in these crazy ass religions, you know, like, no offense, but offense. You need to be on offense too. Like, all of this. Okay, so let me break down then how it starts working with even Osiris, because Osiris, and especially Isis and Osiris, because you see, Isis, Osiris, and Sirius is all the same word, by the way. And when we start really getting into the Osiris, Isis, and Sirius realms, because of the level of magic and mysticism, and also, again, the presence of the djinn, we then get to the awareness of how certain animals, too specifically, play a very, very key and fundamental role to the actual vessels or molds being used to create the beings that are coming into these specific situations. Because, again, as remember, there's no such thing as death. So as one enters the netherworld, where do you go? Like, how do you get back into this space? And so these vessels could be summarized as the goats and the sheeps. Okay, so if we were to take this into biblical times, if you may, let's go rewind back to when everybody was wearing Birkenstocks, we would find that there is a stock literally coming from what we can perceive as the spirits of goats and the spirits of sheeps, but now taking on a humanoid form, just like there's another tribe that they are the spirits of dogs. Okay, so mainly, these are domesticated animals, as you start noticing this. For sure, they had the lion tribe, but that was a long time ago. They had the dilute lion tribe, because lion tribe tears shit up all the time. You know, it's just a product in nature of the alchemy. Warring and fighting all the time, the huge matriarch. You know, you find it in the herstory books, right? But I'm talking about specifically now, as the replicas are coming forth, we enter goat and sheep time, okay? And if you observe goats and sheep, you'll find that one is a little more prone to loving, while another one is more prone to kind of like fighting. And if you ever watch rams, which are like, you know, the daddies of the goats, they just be in there like, boom. Have you ever watched that? They be really testing each other's mettle, because as I said before, that's what they do. Trying to get them not to do that is like trying to get you not to kiss somebody you like. But you don't get it, though, because you're not like that. But some amongst us are. So this, again, to make it very simple, is the sheep and the goats. So in the sheep and the goats, they have two different books. One carries a Bible and the other one carries a Quran. If you ever read the Quran, because I actually used to be a Muslim. Man, it's exactly what you want when you want to bring that fire. If you feel like that you're doing everything right and everybody else is doing everything wrong, Quran is for you, because this is where you can literally send fire and hatred and bombard every wicked one with huge projectiles, like we'll slam meteors at you. So it's very creatively destructive, if you notice, versus the Bible kind of starts chilling that out by the New Testament, and they got a brighter idea. For the sheep, because the shepherd is here. You see what I mean? And but peep it out. So then they start calling it the double-edged sword, because remember, embedded within all these systems is real magic, real code, real power. So that was known as the Abjad. So there's an Abjad, as you know, to the Quran. The Abjad is the numerical equivalent of all the words, because if you reach wazir or you reach sharif, you need to know how to deal with jinn. And then the Kabbalah is the other component of the double-edged sword. And this, of course, is in Hebrew. So these two, have I mean, if you really peep it out, it's like, so one has Hebrew, the other one has Arabic. Now, if they ever mashed these two together, they would have a curve and a straight line. But because they always are beefing, they can't figure out how to put the whole thing together again. They just stay juxtaposed against each other because that is exactly how it was designed. And it was created for them to stay interlocked into a perpetual war where Set, who will always be having you working, and Osiris, who will always be reaping, would always keep their kingdoms full and their lands full because, as I mentioned before, they were really beings who were like, I'm going to control it all. But I'm telling you, they also got that from their mother. And even beyond the mothers, like even Venus and these kind of mothers, there's a higher, there's it goes back further. Look what I'm showing you on that chart I was showing you earlier. It's like, you got to go a long time before you get to what we're calling the divine sacred mother. Generally, you're dealing with the daughters and Electra and them and how they act and what they got going on in conjunction with their brothers is pretty much like when you look at some of your more crazier aunts and uncles because it's still resonant in them. But you would get that attitude, which you probably don't see much in men today, of I'm going to take over the world. And they would really mean it. But to take over the world meant that you would really be battling. And then ultimately, anyone who possessed that state of consciousness will already merge with what we became known or what was known as Satan. And so every king in the world was a Satanist in that respect. Every priest, every real priest in the world was an Osirian in that respect. But as far as their legacies, meaning did they really understand, did all of them really understand what had happened with leaving the mother, what had happened with creating the false world? All of that was something that generally was revealed later on, if ever. And that's what you notice within the Bible and the Quran. There's very little revealing of the inner workings of what actually happened before the beginning, as they are saying it. And that was by design. So as we keep going forward, we find that then Osiris, so now that the world, okay, so remember, what is this agreement about? This agreement is about because when looking at the state of the world and listening to the portal and what was going to happen in the future, it becomes quite aware that if you're keeping every single person in a stage of confinement, that they cannot think freely. And failing to think freely means that certain things that need to come into creation will not come into creation. You cannot beat a person down or imprison them and expect for them to deliver great things. It's like you can't beat a child consistently and hurt a child and then expect for that child to then become the greatest person in the world. Generally, it will damage them in some way, shape, or form. So when the vision of the new world was coming through, there was absolutely no real beings to manifest that world because they were all damaged. And you can go to countries like sometimes like Romania and go to the hood and see that people are broken. It's deeper than what you will ever see, even in a slum in New York. That's why, you know, all realms are here on Earth. There's replicas to all realms. You can dive into Mogadishu and be about 5 or 6 layers down in the netherworld. That's how this works. When you cross over into those realms, you're entering into the bodies of different entities that are stacked into these regions, right? And so in that respect, because there's always this idea, they call it as above, so below, right? So there's always this idea to actually like plug, and we've talked about this, to plug the fictitious reality into the real world a bit. So they govern that. And that's why I say there's watchmen. So they try to basically make this as close to the real world or the real existence of the real realms as possible, but still omitting certain things, which makes this world basically like fake. You see what I mean? It's like it doesn't have the mineral or materia to actually really bring forth, you know, it's like the vigor, right? To the potency, okay? And that's them in a consistent process of watering down this particular species to a point where it's almost like it's barren in itself. It's like a sterile in itself, right? But that's not everybody. And so there's an awareness then that, so when Osiris, again, so Osiris and Set begin to, one, set designs, multiple corporations, Microsoft. This is why you see all of CERN. This is why you see all of their symbolism within that stuff. Because they still operate that all the way, still like a pyramid where nobody knows what's going on except for the people that are at the top. And the people who are at the top, they actually work the Abjad and the Kabbalah. And they set the contracts who are to the people that they're bound to in those papers. And then that stuff that was going on, like even the Sibyls were contacting Jin and actually making contracts and marriages with Jin. So this whole process of contracting human souls and all that kind of stuff, it's old stuff. So this wasn't anything new. But when Saturn implemented, he implemented it at scale, or it implemented it at scale. Meaning that then the whole world started basically working as one machine to develop a new world, to actually build this, to build this, what we're in right now. But still, there's another component to this world that has to exist, and that's the underworld. And so that's where Osiris came in. And Osiris needed to, and I'm, again, giving this like a story. So Osiris needed to actually have operatives or connections here inside of the physical plane in order to basically work the magic here in the space. And this became Hollywood. This is why an Oscar is Osiris. Go look at it. And what it's literally saying, an Oscar, a vehicle for Osiris. So if you won an Oscar, it meant that you had finally become a vehicle for Osiris. And anytime, you know, for an adept, anytime you watch a movie, when you watch a movie of an initiation, there will be a scene where there will be a helicopter and then there will be a Maltese cross or an eight-pointed star in that same scene. I can show you 30 or 40 movies of actors in a scene in a movie. All of a sudden, a helicopter will show up. Then the Maltese cross, like the queen would wear, would be on the ground. And then the actor would be in the middle like, ah, right? Because that's all of the initiation, because the initiations are Osirian initiations of a specific degree. Now, remember, what I was going to tell you earlier is that all of this stuff was the lesser knowledge. Solomon was called it the lesser grimoire. He was talking about that the netherworld was like, basically, it wasn't necessarily something to aspire for. That it wasn't the shit. It wasn't like the highest level that you can reach. That everything here was basically like broke magic. And it holds to this day. Like when you read these magical books and stuff they be talking about doing and getting, it's like, man, why would you even do that, man? Like you're just like scum anyway. You probably need to go wherever that stuff is eventually going to send you. So when you come back, you'll actually know what you really had. Like, even for some of us, like, I did do a little time. I did a year and a half, well, actually 2 year and a half stints. And that time, when somebody takes your freedom away, it's like a whole different thing. Like, you be, like, that's what I'm saying. I could never complain about what I'm experiencing now because I've experienced situations that really hit you. Like, when you can't go anywhere. You can't eat when you want to eat. Go eat dinner. You can't touch people. These kind of things. And when that ability is stripped from you, you realize what you had. And if you come forth from that, then it strengthens you and it gives you the ability to realize what's going on around you. So again, also, when I'm talking about Osiris and I'm talking about Set and I'm talking about this process, I'm not talking about this in a negative or a positive way. Like, I don't feel negative or positive when I'm talking about this stuff. I stay in the Sushumna. That's the only reason why I was able to figure it out in the first place. Because if I was only going to do the Bible, then I would have missed out on the Quran. If I was only going to do the Quran, then I would have missed out on the Siddha Apigrapha. If I was going to do that, then I would have missed out on. So I learned that through the whole process that, well, seven, if you don't like them, though, then that tends to mean you don't study them and you don't learn really what's going on. And then in that, you don't learn about yourself. And you're still not admitting that all is self, even though those words come from your mouth, because you're ashamed of yourself. You keep finding your name, your ancestors. Like that whole big blow up about even King Charles, Charlemagne, a black man, the immortal Charlemagne. Shit, that's why we know this realm is a replica. Because the only one we get right now, Charlemagne probably listening right now, King Charles, Carlos, Carl. So these are, but these men enslaved half of the world. You know what I mean? Jamestown, King James, right? But these men enslaved. You see what I mean? Well, oh, that's uncomfortable. Oh, brother, oh, wait, let's back up. Hold on now. You see what I mean? Because it's uncomfortable. Until you get to the point where you're ready to take on the responsibility, and then your eyes will be open. You'll realize that Tupac was really a thuggy. That he was really a servant of Kali from the West Side. That these entities, they, the ones that we're calling the stars, that they come in and out of the lives to live again through, I mean, you would say through the person, but to the very fiber, it be them. And then they dip again, like Christ. They die, and then they resurrect in somebody else. And it's so refined now. Like I said, the Osirian technology system, I call it Osirian management systems, they find a perfect molded vessel, like a LeBron James, if you may. No offense, LeBron. But they'll find, or like a Idris Elba. No offense, Idris. You know, Idris and the Djinn. You know, you see the 3,000 Nights of Loneliness. That's real stuff. That's Idris. Or is it Iblis? Is it a difference? But are we not seeing what's going on here? Because see, that same projector, as I was saying, that same projector, this kind of projection is the same thing that how a camera in Hollywood works. This is the same way Phantasmagoria works. This is even the same way three-dimensional technology, AR, VR, works. But the animators, the players in the game, we seem to not see how it's all a process and how many have getting casted into certain roles and hold power and don't even know what to do with the power. This is not about demonizing these people. It's about waking them up. Wake your ass up. It's like you think. Because you can't imagine that somebody like Snoop Dogg is not realizing that he's Anubis and playing that role. Signed to death row after this period of time, right? But then there's others that you may feel like they still haven't, you know, got it completely yet about what they're about to get into. And again, you'll see in the Osirian management systems, Kabbalists as lawyers, like Liar Cohen. A Cohen is a priest. He's a Khan. He will sign the contract. He will use the rights of ISIS and the legalese to bind that soul for a term. And that soul will have to make good on that contract. You will need to produce these 7 albums. And if you try to break that contract, in the afterlife, it will be enforced. If you don't have another tether, if you don't have another awareness, you see what's happening? It's like if a person doesn't have another awareness, because they'd be stuck in these churches, like Buddy who was revealing the Boulay was showing how that the churches become the controllers of all of these, like who's controlling this guy? Who's the handler? And in many ways, the church would be the handler. That's why there'd be the church that all the stars and actors go to. The pastor there is initiated. Nobody even knows. And all I'm just saying is that if this is going to continue to go on, it's going to go on with everybody knowing about it. Because the time of it being a secret is over. You can see that now. It's like everything is out. That's why there's so much distraction going on, because like literally we are sitting on the brink of understanding the continuum and being able to tap into it. We all dream. But then they got to keep running this distraction in small because they're on the brink of losing their raggedy ass kingdom. Where everybody works and everybody's slave and everyone's disgruntled and the magic is all weird. None of it really helps. It's like a monkey's paw. You get something, but it costs you more than it was to get it. It costs you more to get it than it was to put in. You know what I mean? So when we have these, so going forward, this again, so when we understand the goats and the sheeps, we also understand the Osirian mysteries, which again is the, we talked about this. It was the cherubim. I want to say the seraphim, but there's actually another one that is, I think it's the Urim right? And these are the goats and the sheep. This is, again, why they say he's the goat of all time. This is the Baphomet creature that people are showing all the time. But that is a cognate of, if you understand anything about the Arab tradition, you'll know that a goat is sacrificed even at a wedding, right? And if you read Wombs and Alien Spirits, you'll understand that actually the whole marriage process was something that was binding a female woman to a jinn, selling a woman to a jinn. And in that process, the male just played the host for the jinn. Like, it would use his body when he was impregnating the woman. And then to get the entity to leave, or for it to be able to leave, it needed to detract from the person, because it's like magnetics. So when the jinn was infused into the person, it would attract to them. But then an exorcism, if you may, needed to happen. But that's like a magnetic thing. So then they would bring in a goat and they would cut the goat's throat. And when they would do that, the smell of the goat would attract the jinn more than the man that he was in. And the goat would they would bring the goat in, and then the jinn would go into the goat, and they would slice the goat's neck, and the jinn would leave through the goat. That is what we're talking about. See, that, again, that technology, which is necromancy, okay, that's why we then have dead presidents, right? That's, you call that money, it's dead presidents. It's talismans with dead people on them with their signature binding as a contract, because they're all Osirians. They serve Osiris. That's why all the Freemasonry and all that stuff, that's all Osirian stuff. But it gets into the more spiritual aspects of things. That's why they told you that there's two ladders in Freemasonry. There's the business one. You know, if you're a soccer player or whatever, you go to that side. And then there's a spiritual one. And if you're going to go into all the occult mysteries and OTO and the Golden Dawn, then you go to that side. But the craft that they're actually in, come on, man. Come on. So let's finish up here. So we're continuing here. So why did they decide to work together? Because, you know, they still got beef. There's still fights, skirmishes. Like, it's just it's their nature. It's their very nature. And that's why we're trying to wean it out of the youth. We're trying to wean it out of all those, like, look, just go. Expand. You know this now, but don't look back. Because this is always going to be here. Like, don't expect Osiris and Set and any of these characters to be going anywhere. This code, this program is going to remain as it is and continuously petaflop on what it's doing. But for you, though, the potential is truly endless. Even right now, if you understand these mysteries, for sure, in our coding, good is 180 degrees evil, 180 degrees good again. So meaning there's a way to basically back check every single system of knowledge and that is here and present, even from its negative side, to see what is the positron, what is the real driving component that we need to learn and to adapt. Sometimes we can have the ability to throw the baby out with the bathwater, as they call it. And that basically is like, once you start seeing how contaminated a lot of stuff is, you just try to throw it all away. But then you also will be throwing away many of the mysteries that took thousands of years to uncover. That's why we're even learning any of this right now. If it was unnecessary for you to have it all, then there would be no reason for any of these spiritual teachers on YouTube right now, period. So there's a value in this knowledge and in this awareness, and there is a vision, there is an energy, there is a constant to remove beings from these systems of confinement, warfare, and all that kind of stuff into something greater. But they now need to understand what you're moving from, though. You got to know what you're moving from. And so they decided to work together. The same, why did they decide to work together is the same reason why you use both of your hands. The same reason why you use both of your feet. Meaning that you will get forces that decide to work together because they will realize the greater potential of when they work together. So that still goes across the board for all of us. If Osiris and Set can get along, I mean, you know, you tear a cat's eye out. you cut off a cat's thing, you know what I mean? That's the same thing that happened to Lala and Lalu. I mean, it's kind of hard to come back from that, but somehow they still got back together. Why? Because they realized there's two components sitting on two different sides that they actually can catch everything in the center. And that same algorithmic dynamic is the same one that exists for you. It's like using both hands, using both feet to run. Like, you're seeing the duality all the time, but you got to realize there's a point where the duality gets used to actually push something together. Like marriages are supposed to be, relationships are supposed to be, all the ships are supposed to be that, working together. But that's something that even you have to train yourself to do, because generally, because of the conditioning, they are opposed to each other. So when we're radiating and we're emitting the balance, we're attracting the energies that actually have got to that stage of balance. And that's how you switch your frequencies. But when you're constantly focusing on the distortion, and I've been through this personally, like wanting to go to battle, wanting to go to warfare and all this kind of stuff against whoever it is you can create in your mind today, and never realizing that you're just knocking off the head of one of your ancestors again. You might as well just move on. So what we have here is we have, as I mentioned earlier, that you may need to learn how to operate in these worlds. That, I mean, that seems obvious. But truthfully, you can see at times you'll be betwixt, as I mentioned before. Like, we'll be like, talking about, like I said, talking about how horrible technology is on our cell phone. We'll be hating the controllers and their banking systems and using Cash App. I mean, it's just like, but see, what people are not realizing is what that actually does. It's better for you to just not do anything. That's what masters are about. They don't let it fluctuate. Everything is like a time and a season, a means to something else that's greater and higher. But then when you go in like hating it and war, then it draws you in, because now you're like on, you're on that side, but then you, but you're still in it. And this is what sends mixed signals to our consciousness. Because remember, our consciousness is like, our mind is just like, yo, what is going on? Our minds are still trying to figure out what is the hell going on. This is a whirl for the mind. It's in the days of a week. You see what I mean? Like inside of Anu, like it's, the condition that the being is actually in is scattered. So that's why, again, every single masterful teaching will conclude with you getting control of your mind and realizing that your mind, like if you have all your mind here right now, you can move. You move objects. Things happen. There's a whole nother realm. And when you can bring all of those yous into your consciousness, all those things that you're connected to, instead of being all at the mall, you know, all over there hating somebody else in your mind, over in another world, just like you see in the dream. In the dream, you be all over the place. I be too, like, man, like, yo, what is going on? It seems like every night there's a movie starring me. And, you know, I jump into that vessel until I get control. I just have to go with the flow. But then when you start coming into your being and you start centering yourself, now you call up the world. You make the story. You bring in the stars. You become the star. And so there's some final things here. I wanted to talk about protection. Because somebody like, yo, you know, all these things running around here, man. How am I going to protect myself? Your aura. Your aura is your armor. You know, give it or take it. take it or lose it. You're wrapped in your armor. That's what the Taurus field is. And when something can puncture that, that's why they saw the Sumerians at the tree and they got this cone in their hand and they're they got the cone on there. And if you see the rest of those glyphs, it shows that somehow the tree represents human beings as we know them. And the cone is a device used to drill into their aura. And then once you can drill in, it's like tapping a tree. You know, you tap in the bark, and then now it's just leaking through that. So your protection is staying wrapped tight. Not letting things break through your hermetic seals. It's not worth it. Stay jubilant. Like, staying naturally happy attracts that force. Some people are like, man, you're just naturally happy. I mean, for sure, I can get angry. I can get mad. I can get upset. Because all those energies, like when I blend all those energies together in the alchemical chamber, they're going to come out into being something new, useful. But I know how to regulate those energies. And sometimes they get out of control. It'd be like a science experiment and just start blowing up and burning down the place. So I'm just saying, but at least it's that awareness in that you're dealing with volatile components. So it's like, hey, you know, before you watch that, or you know what you're going to get into. You know how you are. You make a judgment, before you go in there and talk to her, you know how you are. You know, you have those moments with yourself because you understand as an adept what's at stake. That's another thing. It's like, if you don't have anything to lose, then, you know, you just don't have anything to lose. But shoot, when you're sitting at 90 degrees of mercury and that's your thermometer right there. And then, you know, as far as your power and your wisdom, and then somebody taps that and all your power flows out into that and you're just drained. And maybe somebody, you know, depending on how much power you have. See, the reality to all of this is the more degrees of the DNA kundalini you have, and if you can't control it, you will even kill somebody. Like, your anger will turn into rage very fast. That's why these kings were always like that. They were always killing people. Like, if you piss them off, you're gone. Because they got so much of this energy and they can't control it. They can't. It's telling them what to do. That's the whole thing with all this in power. It's like, few people can get certain levels of awareness and then not take that and use that to try to imprison others and rule over them. I know more. I'm the best. This is the best. I got the most. That, you gotta watch that. That turns into something else when we take it up 10, 20 more degrees of energies, because all of it's energy. So when you get the Therian and you know all this knowledge, where do you think that comes from? You think it's yours? You think you're the only one that knows, right? Or could it be that you're also being exposed and influenced by a light or an energy, and it's starting to fill you? That's because of the Holy Ghost, Sophia, wisdom. It starts to fill you, and then it's like an ocean. And it's like you're just getting filled with water. And you get to your neck, and then you drown in it. Hopefully you live again. But this is a real thing. I'm going to show a video here in a moment. I call it Never Forget. And then we're going to open this up for some questions. Sean's going to feed some questions to me. Where's my cell phone at? Yeah, it made it. Okay. But I have a few more things that I wanted to say. But just remember, again, so people, you're asking me, what is your greatest defense against? Just stay wrapped tight. Like, really be on point. Realize that when you leak energy, your energy is really going somewhere, and something really wants that energy. It's not exactly invisible, meaning that it's not nothing going on when you're getting upset and angry. There's another detail. As I mentioned, Saturn's other detail is a large group of minions. And they're not as cute as the ones on the Disney thing or the Pixar thing. And these minions have a detail to extract your gems, which is your stability. Right? We talked about it earlier. It's your stability. It's your unity. Right? So your balance. So they have a detail to get that from you, to tap that. And if they can't get that, there it's no reward for them when they get back to where they go. There's even a little punishment. And they come back more upset to try it again. And you'll even be noticing with folks, you'll be like, kind of throw it off. It's like, this is not even making any sense. Why are you upset? And it's just like, they're under the influence. And it's happening. It's happening more than ever. But just like that's happening more than ever, you can get out of body easier than ever. You can project your own reality easier than ever. Remember, okay, so at this stage, this is what we've done. We've created an entire conscious ecosystem, okay? Whether people are using it or not, like I said, I'm just working on it because I know it will be useful very shortly, right? But it's got everything in it, right? Everything you need to know about yourself, all the elements and everything. We created financial ability for everybody to sustain themselves if they want to use the system without even degrading themselves at all and actually assisting others. This is things that we created, we built. So I'm not just sitting here talking about esoteric knowledge. I love it. I'm a connoisseur of it. But I also know that it's important for me to let my mouth align with my heart, align with my mind, align with all the other things that I have and put them to service to the cause. And I'm a lover, not a fighter. I just have to admit it. Like, I love the love. Like, it's just me. I have to accept that. You got to figure out what you are. Like, I love the Taurus. I love gyroscopes. I love this kind of thing, this perpetual energy thing I'm in. You know what I mean? So I don't feel like that this is a bad thing for me. Like, that's it. So, again, I'm not trying to be like anybody else. The one who has the most wisdom is the one that is not always influenced by everything they hear, but yet will listen. I will listen. And I will be able to extract gems. I got a natural alchemical jewel extraction vessel. Shoot, I can eat a couple things and turn it into the seed of life. So it shows you have the equipment. You got this equipment. It's not all doom and gloom. It's not. It can't be. There's no way many of these forces can exist without the highest levels of knowledge and ability and presence and love and connection being present. You just got to figure out which one you want, though, and that is by your actions, and your actions are your thought, and that's why they say your thoughts are quick, and we be like slow, not being able to capture our thoughts because we're sitting in the wrong vehicle. This is where we to think. My mom said, we're the think, and it is beings. I think where I want to be, and I go there, just like that, faster than the speed of light, thought. So I also wanted to say, you know, we have a school of metaphysics. So I'm not gone off the, I'm not people like, man, you haven't been in YouTube in a while. Yeah, live. Because a lot of stuff, like, it's a continuous build. So sometimes I'll be like, I got to come in here. And, you know, if it may be just foreign to everybody, you know, but when I come into the tribe, we just pick off from where we left off last time. And anybody that is new, they just catch up with all the materials that are there. There's 700 videos sitting here on YouTube. Imagine. 700. If I had any intention of giving up, I probably should have did it on like number 3, 4, 5, 50 at least, not 700. And then there's another 400 in the metaphysical university. That's there. We invented things. We constructed spiritual technologies and we're still going with this awareness. It's like, yo, but still though, I think the sun's a gyroscope. And I believe that this kind of technology, like, we should be having personal energy systems. Some will be like, oh my goodness, brother, we can't do nothing like that. But yet we got toasters and shit. We got microwaves. And it's like everything but the high levels. That's why I say every time you get hit with somebody, it's like, oh, brother, you shouldn't be believing in that, seeing that, doing that, learning that, thinking that. That's why I'd be like, man, I'm in my own lane, man. You cannot control what I'm doing. It's gnosis, right? This is the gnosis system. And in the gnosis system, we have access to everything. But there is a current. There is a trend. And that's why when most people like, if I decide that I like you, I never decide that I don't like you. That's how I work. So I can make sure that I'm not being disturbed by anything that may just be coming through for the moment. If I like you, I like you because it's a vibe thing. Like, I've been working on my discernment for years, lifetimes. So I also wanted to, you know, send respect to my brother Sanchez. I send respect to Pierre Sabak. Like, I don't know who these beings are. Don't care. I just know they're other variants of me. The level in which they've bought into the space of the awareness, forever grateful. Forever grateful. Pierre Sabak, the murder of reality, the whole breakdown of the language, priceless. You do need to know what you're doing, though. You need to get your rigging. You definitely need to learn how to balance out. And, you know, there's a lot of things to be upset about, and there's a lot of atrocities that have occurred from certain beings. But in the end, when you know the whole story, it's empowering. Vivian Hunter, that's the one who wrote the Mommy Wada Priestess books. Man, forever giving thanks. No one would ever have known that the Jesuits had taken all of what they have from the Sibyls, and this is why we're in this condition even today. And just to hearken back to the time of the Oracle system. Now, that's why they got that in the Matrix. They go see the Oracle. Who's the Oracle? Sibyl. Why was she a black woman? Well, because she's a mermaid. You see what I mean? And just all of that knowledge and being aware, without that, we're lost. Without Vivian Hunter, people are lost. They won't know, they won't be able to put together the other side of the esoteric knowledge to understand what happened before the sons rebelled, or rebellious ass sons, right? Kin cousins. You know, the real sovereign Bill. Remember, all our ancestors are sovereigns, for better or for worse. There are some really, 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 really dangerous sovereigns also. Sovereign doesn't mean the good one. It just means you have the ability to sustain yourself. You have your own power. You don't draw power from anything but yourself. And that's something I feel like that we all should be working towards, is getting sovereign and getting out of debt, becoming the Lord and the masters of our own lives. Also, let me check the name. I believe it's Dolores Cannon. The Day of the Fish. Let me check it. All right, somebody has to share. I believe it's Dolores Cannon. I know it's Dolores, but I'm typing the Day of the Fish, and it should be coming up, but it's not. But again, like, again, if it was up to them, all the knowledge would be removed, but it's not. Dolores Cannon. Who's Dolores Cannon? To check her out. Shannon Dory. Thank you. Shannon Dory. You know, all of those books, once you have these components, Neil Haig, I have to mention, because that Orion bill he has with Pierre Sabak, it's like the lights just turn on. Just like any of these bills, like when I'm in present in any of these bills from any of these people, like, man, it's like, see, some, you almost feel like it's really for you, right? Like, even probably some listening to this, like, man, this message is for me because I'm something special. So when I'm in this with these beings, I'm like, man, this is for me. And I want you to understand that's a universal feeling, though. And the more of these beings, and there's more. I can't say that I've mentioned it all. This was just for tonight. Like, when I come through, I have another list, another five. Because I'll be like, yo, what's your top five? and not raptors, you know what I mean? Like, remember, in Kemet, they were reincarnating raptors, which is a carnivorous bird. And that's what rappers became, by the way. There is a real deep level to every single thing that we're actually seeing and what's happening to many of the beings here. But again, it's like, it's influence. That's why we have mentors. Because mentors they influence. You see what I mean? You need good influences around you. That's what stars are. They influence. The moon is influencing. So we're influential beings. We get influenced. Right? So when you surround your field with things that are influencing you in a harmonic way, in a balanced way, you see what I mean? And then, but the way that happens, though, is you got to know where to put that piece. You see what I mean? Like, it doesn't mean that I believe every single thing that everybody is saying. I don't have to. It's a vibe. Like, I listen to a person's voice. And I hear everything they know, because what they are is not in their words. It's in their vibration and frequency. So I just listen. And you can hear the truth. And it's not in what they're saying. It's actually, meaning that they do have some knowledge. I'm not saying they're lying, but I'm just saying there's another something else there. And at the core, it's their love and desire to really transmit this knowledge to who they've been sent to. Because you got to remember, like, many people have been sent to different types of people. Right? Like, there's a certain kind of person that unlocks a certain kind of door for another one, but we're showing up. And then when you have your team of beings, right? Like all of the people who have come into this space now and have delivered this knowledge and wisdom, like I see them astrally, right? And then you see, like, this ain't no fake ass Ashtar Command with some suit on and talking about some Zeta Reticulians. I'm talking about beings that are alive right now and bring that. They bring the power and the force with them. And see, what's happening now is that it's a time thing rolling out. And that's why it's all time with the whole quote-unquote singularity. It's all time with the big change in the economy. It's all timed. And I'm telling you, it's all going to line up perfectly and continue to line up perfectly for the beings that are here. If you're at this stage, keep going. I can tell you that this is not something like that's just like normal per se. Like right now, the knowledge is coming to the beings that are actually going to make the massive transformations in themselves. True, we will have our vibration and nucleuses and constants here inside of this space called Earth. This simulation called whatever we're calling it today. But the goal is to be able to contact and connect and remain stabilized and consistent in the continuum. When you come out of this, you won't be just drifting into nothing. You'll be recognizing the tribe who have refined consistently the spaces that we inhabit and we build. We will share dreams. We will respect spaces. These are all the things that we've learned from here. And more that I continuously allow myself personally to maintain balance, the more that I can actually be here for you. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick moment. I'm going to pop on a video. It lasts about 5 minutes. This will give me time to refresh myself. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and we're going to answer some questions. And we did say we were going to set a limit on questions. We said the limit would be 10. So I'll see what everybody decides today. Somebody said 9. We're going to set some type of limit on questions, but we are going to get to questions. So if you do have a question, we ask that you write question first and then the question, so that way we can actually see it. These questions will be filtered a little bit because, you know, if we've already went over it, man, you got the 700 to go through on YouTube, but we do want to make sure that we at least open up the space so that we're breathing in, we're breathing out. I also wanted to mention that also, you know, we got the School of Metaphysics, we invented the constructive spiritual technologies, but we're also really, really powering through for inner city youth. Like, if you haven't heard about Chess and Community, Google it, check it out. You know, my brother Lemuel, you know, he's dedicated his life to this, 25, 30 years into assisting your children, our children. We've also began STEM Kids, stemkids.io. You'll check it out there. It's us in the community actually making sure our children are not getting left behind because they have no clue of what kind of technologies are here and available, robotics, all these kind of things. Like, they're going to need jobs. So why should they be your bagger, right? And then also, we just launched Dream Engine, which actually has already completed a process with the children. Actually, it's about to be complete. And we've allowed them to take their imagination and bring it into reality with text to image. And it has been incredible because we just, you know, we're like some of the first people in it. So at this stage, we really, really understand how to operate it. And it's just been incredible watching the children create their own avatars, create their own heroes. So instead of Young Thug being on the wall, now they have a being that they've created from their mind that they know has the power that they gave it, right? So these are being able to utilize the things that are here, even though they're still kind of crude to what our ancestors had, but to do the greatest things within our children's mind, to actually be there. Because I do remember as a child that I was always looking for somebody to take me under their wing, and I didn't find anybody. And that's probably why I got into all the trouble I got into. You know what I mean? I was always looking for like older kids to even like hang out with. And they, you know, they never, older kids was mean. They didn't want you around. And so I remember those times, even adults wouldn't, you know, get out my, you know, I come from the age where you couldn't talk around adults really. They would even be like, kid, get out of here. You know what I mean? So now, you know, in realizing how I came from that, I realized the reality I needed to create for children when they're around me. Right. So that's that consistent optimization that we're doing here to the DNA. Right. Like, I'm not throwing all this stuff away for nobody. The optimization here is incredible. The potential of what can be done. Like at this stage, if anybody takes a moment, just goes through everything that I've just said that we've accomplished, you can go and find it. And you'll see a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of intention was put into it. I barely have a GED. When I was graduating high school, I finished all the work and the teacher didn't allow me to turn in all the high school work because she said I was too young. I had already been double promoted when I was younger and skipped two grades. But then when I got to try to get my diploma, they wouldn't give it to me. And man, so much happened that next 2 years. Menace to Society came out. Everybody wanted to be like Old Dog. I kind of parked my head down the middle and kind of combed my hair down and kind of got some tight ass braids on my head, start carrying a gun. And you see what I mean? So it's just like, this is, again, that's what I was saying, mentorship. And like being there is so impacting to worlds. You'd be surprised. But as far as them saying that you need to go through or do specific things to get to this level, you will not know what those details are until you get into it yourself and do them. Meaning that there's no linear path. It's like you can't be like, I'm going to be a doctor, so I'm going to go and do 8 years of residency and then expect 8 years later that you're going to be a doctor. Things don't have a tendency to work out like that. It's about setting those intentions, and then a series of events occur. The next thing you know, you're the doctor. But it'd probably be a holistic one. So let's take a moment. I'm going to turn this on. Let me see. Where's my dashboard over here? Let me see what they've done over here. The captions, the chat. Oh my goodness. It's just right here on the screen. All right, everybody, give me just a quick second. I'm on this dashboard and I need to find where my videos were. Right, this is probably the perfect time to take a nice deep breath to realize that we are it. I want to give thanks to everybody who had the opportunity to come in this evening and share their energy into the space. It's extremely important. I can definitely say if there was only one person here on the line, I probably for sure would be doing something else, yet there's 1,000. So I'm here for you. Here's that video. I guess that was a lot shorter than I thought it was, but it's just that awareness of remembering, like right now I was talking to my daughter Ara and I was explaining to her that you know, a lot of the stuff that we're seeing on TV and stuff could give us the ideas that spiritual power is not real, like they be watching, you know, the Avatar and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, they see these powers and they just be like, okay, they start to throw it in that column that this is stuff that only happens on cartoons. And I feel like I feel that in the reality, you feel that they just are trying to get everybody to forget about that there's spiritual powers and you can control your dreams and all these kind of things, all that's going under carpet. So I showed her these videos. Of course, she loved it. And it's just, again, that awareness, because some of us need to kind of return to that childlike aspect of ourselves and realize that the power is real. You know, and many of us are so close to it. Like, you would think that you got to go in 20 years as a Shaolin monk to be able to set stuff on fire with your right hand and realize that it's already in your DNA. It's already something that you already are aware of. You don't even have to need to train yourself over again to do it because you spent that lifetime already. Naga! But the reality is that you would still need to come to that awareness. You still need to realize that that's valuable for you, because truly what you're looking at is any of those people who know how to harness their chi like that don't die. It's the same thing with what they were talking about with Yogananda. It's like when they pass on, their body is still warm. They're still in the room. Like if you look at one of these videos, I'll send the link. But the guy says, you know, basically it's my thoughts. My thoughts are over there. And what I do is I move my thoughts over here and it affects his whole field. And it's just, again, that awareness that when you can concentrate your thought, it does amazing things. It heals. It can set things on fire. It can throw men across the room. It could do really anything. And imagine what it's like when you're going to, quote unquote, sleep in a body like that. When the physical body no longer can hold or sustain the mental body, where do you go? There is no limits. So I'm going to take a quick moment and let's throw on some music. Let's just take about a 5 minute. Let me set the clock here. Take about 5 minutes, and we're going to answer some questions. And, you know, for those that may be trying to drive off right now, of course, you're more than welcome to, but I always would say that some of those gems are dropped in the last moment, especially with the questions, because it could spark, you know, something that you may have wanted to know anyway. So let's go ahead and just start the timer, and we're going to come forward. This is a good time, again, for you to relax, stretch out a little bit. You know, this is a recording, so you will, I mean, it has been recorded, so you will be able to catch it later. And, but yeah. That's what it is. All right, if you have a question, Sean's going to be writing down those questions. He's going to be sending them to me on my side of things. All you need to do is type in question before you put that question in.
First one who wanted to see my youngest son.
Your awareness may be powerful enough to control your instincts. Your instinct will be to remove your hand from the box.
Fire. So you know math is never just numbers. In the wrong hands, it's a weapon. In the right hands, deliverance.
We get to, at a certain point, this eighth and ninth dimensional being.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and start the process here of answering a few of the questions that have been presented. We've actually reached that 3-hour mark, which seems to be a normal process here. We would love for everybody to be able to go forward from this evening and continue to enjoy their life and enjoy the existence that they're in. Hopefully, my original intentions, which was to make your existence better, was able to be fulfilled for those who have remained. Thank you so much. And yeah, so the first question here is from Lizelle, and there, she's asking what to do when you're in a crisis besides breathe. What is a good thing to do? And, you know, just to answer this right off, like the process of dealing with a crisis is something that you generally should prepare for through meditation. So before you reach a crisis level, meditation should be practiced, because once you reach a crisis, then you would go into the same frequency that you're already used to in your meditation, which would be a constant for you. I know there's a few things that are capable of doing that now. Even Muse headset helps with this focus. Mindy, there's another headset that helps with this focus of being able to train your mind. And then just standard meditation, like being able to go through the process at least for 6 months of learning how to quiet your mind. And in that, those crises themselves, especially if they're presenting themselves in your life, will actually, you will see the origins to those crises. The next question here is what to do, actually that's the same question. So the next question here is, what are the symptoms and signs that your armor torus field has a hole in it? What ways can you repair it and strengthen it? And so we talk about astral hygiene. Also, you know, giving lots of respect to our brother Daniel Winter, who always goes in about this. If you could type in Daniel Winter, astral hygiene, and really, really get a deep dive from an adept of exactly how to begin to repair your torus field. Because everything from even being sleepy to having bad dreams or feeling like that your mind is constantly being altered or tapped into, or that you can't control your energy. All these are signs and symptoms of having potentially holes in your aura. And don't let us not forget that most people, just like the ozone layer, have holes in their aura and or tears. They generally also occur when you experience a very traumatic situation. This is why the word tear and tear are the same word. Also pain and pain, like money. These are all situations that cause opportunities for stuff to wedge into your field and to decrease the power and potential of your field. So it's just that awareness. But check out Dan Winter. Again, some are asking about, can you mention, the next thing is, can you mention some techniques that regenerate your aura? And again, I would always recommend breathing. We have several breathing videos. To me, it's like the surefire way to tap into your energetic field and to really feel who you are and to really, really understand from that point how to, I think we covered this in vibratory energetics, because at the end of the day, your environment that you're in, even the physical environment, the things that you have in your room, all that can be reconfigured to allow you to strengthen yourself and to gain strength from what's going on around you, but also being aware that things around you that could be distorted or taking away strength could also be present in your environment. So take an opportunity to look at things like vibratory energetics. I think that's one little small course on secret energy. You can type in the search bar and find it. Probably be a good idea to just see all the different ways that sometimes our energy can be tapped and causing our aura to be weakened. The next question here is, for those of us who are actively pursuing sovereignty but for now have regular jobs and work, what advice would you give? I have the awareness that it is war, but it's also means for beginning. Absolutely. I mean, I feel like I'm still working too myself, even managing these networks and developers and all this stuff. You know, you're constantly navigating other psyches, other mindsets, other cultures. Like, I have different people from different countries that I deal with. And really, it's mindfulness, being empathic, bringing that also into the space. So that way you're using these powers and potentials to balance out your environment and turn it in from being a place of warfare to actually a place of wholeness. And not every single job encompasses warfare, but oftentimes you can imagine with large corporations that there is a bottom line for them to continuously perpetuate the madness and the confusion, if you may. And so, yeah, just remembering that is that it's not about condemning yourself for not being a sovereign now. It's about having a plan. Check out Ken Cousins' Gemstone University builds that are there, because they're epic for that step-by-step of you realizing just the commitment that you would need to make to yourself to actually achieve your sovereignty, and then make a plan. Because as he even mentions, it's taken him 10 to 15 years to begin to sketch out how his new life is going to be outside of the governance of the system. The next question here is, what is your take on the divine source coming through two or three people at the same time in order to spread out the energy and not burn out a single individual? I absolutely am in alignment with that, because not all of us are the same. We're all coming from different paths and different experiences, and it's very good to have a spiritual experience or teacher or mentor that's tailored to you. And so that's why I see everyone here as extremely instrumental into the awakening of others. And we also have to remember that even the people who do the bad things, quote unquote, are also instrumental to other people's growth. I mean, it becomes that big checkpoint, and also the ability to give them the discernment that they need to actually really navigate the cosmos rather than having somebody grab the wheel for them all the time. The next question here is, does the light path mean to follow the wheel of time or divine, with the dark path mean to follow the path of the ego? All these are figments of our imagination in the light or dark. They are bearings, meaning that they give us the ability to navigate our own consciousness until we realize that the directions that we go in are really based on where we want to be. And the components of light and dark are simply themselves as defined as whether we want to experience something without knowing what it is, or where we want to see exactly what it is before we experience it. And that is also a matter of preference, just so you understand that. And that's, of course, in dealing with the terms as you've spoken them, because the words dark and light are similar to the words positive and negative. And that's why I like to use words like distorted when I'm referring to more demented things like what people call evil. So the next question here is, can you mention some techniques? Okay, so that was asked already. What is your take on the divine source? Okay, does the light path mean to follow? Okay, so here we go. Question, does one need a wife or a husband to achieve these powers, like expressed in the book Perfect Matrimony? Or is it the same concept happening within? Hold us and thank you. For sure, I've always believed that if you did find someone externally that was actually able to pair with you properly in your journey and experience here, you had found them internally first, and you had actually been able to create that connection there. So always remember, before you see that perfect Mr. Wright, as they will call it, or Mrs. Wright, show up in your life, it will also show up in your being and your consciousness and your awareness of connecting with the opposing pole of yourself, remembering that we contain both masculine and feminine, and we have the ability to actually bring that in balance. The next question here is, this is a part two question, if I may, or two-part question. The first question is related to the organic. What is your perspective? Do you think it's possible to convert the demons to possibly come to the light via my own spiritual technology? This word demon is a very derogatory term. It's actually more of like a catch-all to try to explain a rather large group of beings that in most cases are just disincarnate human beings that actually do not have bodies to go into next. And so as the Quran mentions that when observing and seeing, and this is just their energetic flow, these entities have a tendency to attach themselves to others like barnacle onto a boat, especially the open areas or the holes inside the chakras, in order to be able to be exposed to the energy and siphon the energy that actually keeps them somewhat present and in existence, meaning that things that are forgotten lose power and lose energy. Things that are concentrated upon can even become, if they are phantoms, if you may, or ghosts, they can actually become static for a moment or visible in the physical reality. And all this just hints to that these energetics, every energetic being needs energy, right? And so if you can always really govern what kind of entities are around based on how your attitude is and what you have going on around you and what your environment is actually like, because you're going to attract the beings that harmonize with that space, and you're going to repel beings that actually cannot vibe in that frequency. So that's always important to remember, that we're really governing what's going on in our experience. So if you would come across an entity that you would be converting with spiritual technology, it for sure would mean that they were already on that path, and it would be you as the conduit to get them aware of exactly what the next stage would be for them. The second part of this question is, do you think a human consciousness is safely capable to traverse through the electromagnetic wave through the power lines to program a firewall that prevents any malevolent beings from utilizing AI? Okay, so this term AI, which of course is artificial intelligence, I think that should be more of called just advanced intelligence, because some of the things that are being rolled out are just, again, really replicas of things that are already present within the space, and now it's choosing to live under this term called AI. The truth is that I believe that the human consciousness, now, first, this word human actually is more of a, it is somewhat of a derogatory term when you understand the complete etymology around it, but consciousness itself is safely traverse through spaces, as you're seeing in the dream. Consciousness will die and come back and live again. It doesn't mean that we won't feel the vibrations of those traumas, though, so it's very important to realize that having control of your consciousness is very important at certain stages for you to be able to truly grow. Now, again, preventing malevolent beings from utilizing AI, etc., these are collective decisions made by the collective. And that's why it's also important to designate who you are and then where the collective's at. So sometimes you don't get them confused, because you can actually go beyond where the collective is. It happens all the time. It's like the early fruit blossoming on a tree. So I would say in this case that if you still feel like your goal is to create things that allow distorted frequencies to not enter fields, it's absolutely possible and has been created, because that is exactly what places that are highly concentrated with energy of what you would say is positivity and balance do. And so, again, frequencies, lights, cymatics, colors, geometries, and these kind of things can all be used to promote that or amplify that. This next question is, sometimes when lucid dreaming, my ship won't fly no matter how hard I try. Is it because of lack of fuel? Generally, it's also about whether you've got the air traffic controller saying that you're okay to go. I mean, that for sure, as there's different moons every cycle, that's why there's different feelings. That's why I always say with the cat dragged in, meaning that for that specific time and that specific space, these kind of energies are moving through. And sometimes you're just grounded in those stages so you don't go out there and crash into something. So I always believe that whatever's supposed to happen, as long as I'm staying dialed in and in tune, it's going to happen. And even when I go through these dry spells of feeling like I'm not activated, I also sometimes get dreams and even feel like that it's me. Maybe it's me. Maybe it's something I'm eating. Maybe it's something I'm doing. And I sometimes even right away, a few days later, have like such a strong activation going on in the dream. dream, I'll get that once again, that reassurance that comes from that ancestral side of self that says, listen, you know, at any point, any place, anywhere, baby, we can take you into the next stage and allow you to experience what you would experience there. But remember, your presence is so important here, and focus is important inside of your presence. So yeah, stay in tune, but always know your terms. This next question is, my question is in reference to investing in the programs for children and into the Wealthy Bot program as well. Where and how? Like, all these things are, again, if very directly, Chesson Community is there. Chesson Community has been there, is a wonderful place to not only contribute to, because you can actually see the fun. Or you can call it work, but we call it fun, the fun that's actually put in. And again, you know, I'm just there to support as much as possible. Our brother Lemuel LaRoche has put a lot of time and intention into what he's doing. Also his massive team there, because there's quite a few people who have all united in that cause. And it's a nonprofit, so there's always the need to actually have more resources to consistently help the children. And then WealthyBot in itself, you know, like as we can say that right now, markets are definitely not showing us the best that they can be, but actually that's always the process. In 2008, we went through this exact same process, but educating yourself just on really the emotional subset that it takes to truly be able to thrive in this environment. And that's why I was mentioning earlier, don't be surprised if you need to learn how to operate in other spaces. Sometimes this could be discouraging for us, that we could feel like, well, I'm not going to be like them, or I'm not going to learn any of that because that's part of the problem. And then you'll just be kind of like sitting there, just like floating in mid-space, sometimes depressed because you're not in and you're not out. And for me, it's just about creating a cause within yourself or a purpose, realizing why you're doing all this, and also knowing that some of this stuff is a means to an end. Like I said, when I'm using PayPal, Bank of America, Cash App, it's not like I want to be in that space depending on them at all times. That's why I learned about cryptocurrency. It wasn't just about getting rich overnight, even though that was definitely entertaining. It was really about understanding how to become your own bank. And we've always talked about that. So that information is available to you freely. And there are, of course, many masters on the internet that would love to deliver that information to you also in even a more refined way. And also WealthyBot does have its instructions. These next questions here, I think, are the final questions, and that is, even false realities must function with some sort of nod to the mother, correct? If so, is she hidden by the rebellious sons in this reality? One time the mother showed me herself as everything and told me that even though that there's this process of everybody trying to reject even nature at times, to understand that nature is so powerful that it surrounds everything that we are. So even the computer that you're typing on is made from nature, for real. Like, all this stuff is pulled right from the earth and will go back into the earth. And so I felt that in many ways that the being, as vast as it is, was expressing that it's always embracing us in everything that we're in, because we're actually inside of the house. But there are for sure lots of different programs and entities and energies running around this spectrum. Just as you've been given somewhat some free rein on your decisions that you're making in life, you can imagine the mother's first son has been given quite a bit of free rein, just as a parent will oftentimes give their child more rein than they need. But that's just all a part of the process. Sometimes that becomes a part of the mother's sorrows. And many of the divine feminine in this world have actually seen this and experienced this. So we're able to go to those things for the examples. The last question here is, can you speak on the war in Ukraine and what the message here is for us? I noticed the connection with Enneagrams 3, specifically blue and yellow, and the trident and the coat of arms. What we find in history and her story is that history and her story often repeats itself, that sometimes we see the same factions and the same energies still going blow for blow with each other and trying to even balance out the things that they've experienced in the past. I believe that the total awareness has to come to all of us of just how connected we truly are. And that could take thousands of years for some. It could have already happened for others. But it's just that awareness of when you have to realize that you're actually beating up your own brother and your own sister, and that you even look alike, and that actually your likeness far outweighs your differences. And this is, again, a continuous lesson in this world, is for us to see that truly together, we are much more powerful. I made a joke about this the other day. I didn't want it to be a racial joke, but it ended up being one. But anyway, I was saying that, hey, if 500, you know, 1,000, 2,000 Chinese start dropping from the sky, because that's how they roll. You know what I mean? They come in and they got the whole, you know, they drop in all of the men, right? So this is, you know, if you see something like this, right, and, you know, you kind of run out in the street and then, you know, you see a guy there, a white guy there, he says, hey, I got some guns, just come back to my house. I'm sure you're not going to say, well, wait, I need my reparations first. I'm just saying, it's like when the COVID thing happened and you already witnessed it then, is that these whole little, these finicky little color lines and all that kind of stuff just disappear. And people be just wanting to, like, get some help, feel safe, and be around people that they know can potentially assist them against this force that is destroying and hurting and killing and these kind of things. So I find that most of the there's another question after the last question, but I find again most of these this racism, if you may, is existing because of the convenience, if you may, the convenience of the ability for us to be separate. Right. And so there's a big part of the world that it feeds into these categorical separations in order to allow it to perpetuate this bloodshed that goes on between brothers and sisters. And that's why I've personally committed to, in my mind, dissolving or absolving a lot of the energies that are moving through the space as far as me being in conflict with them. And to realize as a master will is that you don't have to love or hate something. Like there's a higher stage of you that can process and overlay something completely and define everything that it is without it even tugging any of your emotional channels. And it's important to realize that that is accessible to you. This is a special request, this final question here. It says, do you believe a person who is physically ill can still vibrate high? So remember, what we're dealing with is the body is not the mind. And truly, what happens when the body is getting weaker is that the soul is gaining more strength. The body is known as Lord Governor. It is a pentagram, so it is actually the containment unit for light. It is able to trap light in the oob or the corner and allow it to congeal, thus making a physical body called you. And in the event that the physical body gives up the ghost, if you may, it will be giving up the spirit or the soul of the being. So in respect to those who may feel that the body is waning, we've often witnessed that the spirit is now able to fly free. And I would always still, though, encourage anyone who feels sickness to actually understand more about your sickness and the origins of it. Check etiology for natural impediments. These are what we call Phase 1 and phase 2 of Enneology is available for free on Secret Energy. You sign up and it starts deploying in the chat. By the way, that chat is going to be looking real nice in about 1 week since there's a whole new rendition. But these are things that allow you to look deeper into your life to what the true ailments are or what they were in order for you to be able to patch up those holes in your field to get better. And but as I stated, it doesn't mean that all of us from time to time don't get sick. And that also gives us the contrast of understanding what it is like to be well. And so I would love to grant that to all and well wishes to actually be well, to really understand that we are here to make our journeys much more lighter and to allow our existence to be much more happier. We know what we prefer. And that's why we're going through this experience. So I just wanted to say also to everybody, Wholeness and Balance Vibrations, again, thank you so much. It has been real. I love the time. There was obviously a lot going on from the beginning until now, but I feel like we were still able to get through this transmission and in a way where it felt balanced, that we were able to learn the knowledge of, you know, these ancient mysteries and these advanced technologies and all of the circumstances that have occurred in this realm because of them, but also realizing the importance of us to really be just now more aware of the cause and effect of certain things so that we know what we're going to create next. Because bringing in that same type of energy that caused the problem in the first place is probably not going to bring any solution. So it reminds me of the final conversation that Noah gave to Shem, Ham, and Japheth, which is again a metaphor. And it told him, hey, look, We removed all of those energies from the land, the ones that were causing all the trouble. But it looks like the way that you guys are acting with each other, that you're going to bring that energy upon this world again. And I warn you against this. And what it was a reference to is that this energy, this warlike energy, is in many ways a direct conduit for the many souls that have perished here in thinking that that's the way. And that's the way to actually bring some type of solution to a scenario. It's so immature. And it also causes a tear or a rip or an unclosed seam inside of one's path or position in existence. And that's often why people that have been removed by another person haunt that person. So it's just that awareness that we have so much power and so much ability if we choose to take that responsibility. And so that's all I'll say about it. I think I've said enough. It's 3 hours and 30 minutes. I'm going to move on to the other side of life, which of course is the dream world, and also let everybody know once again that, remember, we all dream. So there's many spiritual powers that people want. And, you know, some people even say they have, like we've definitely seen a display of some spiritual powers here on these videos, but we all dream. And in the dream, you can be anything you want as long as you're in control. And being in control of your dream is like controlling the ocean of your subconscious. And that also is your trial every single day. Every time someone comes at you trying to get your gem of stability, right? Every time somebody's trying to come get the gem of balance, every time somebody's trying to come get that gem of unity that you're able to understand. That's our word. We literally said inside you should stand. That's upright, erect, not bent. Wholeness. Thank you. I'm going to go ahead and open up the mic so the tribe can leave some wholeness and balanced vibrations. Y'all may not hear it, though, on the other side of things. So we'll just type it out. Sending love to the family. It was great. Wholeness. 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 Thank you, YouTube. Wholeness. Yes.